Clerk. Are you ready? All right. Is Councilwoman Breckus coming? I was waiting on her.
Madam Mayor, I have not heard if she is not planning to be here. She's not told me as much.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Oh, no, no. That's fine. I just want to make sure all council members are here. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Since this is not a city council meeting, I do want to do something a little bit different in the sense of how we take public comment. I really want everyone's feedback on this presentation. I want you to give us feedback after we sort of hear everything that's been put on the table. So listen intently. But what I'd like to do is let's take a minute of public comment first. Let's have the presentation and then do another 3 minutes of public comment so that I can get your feedback. So actually, everyone will get longer public comment. So.
Are you talking about public comment or the one on the agenda? Not regular public comment. That's
regular.
3 minutes by law. That's the attorney.
Yes, and we'll give you 3 minutes. But you get, guess what, Sam? You get four. I'm going to give you another minute.
But I can't stay here for this whole thing. I got
to. Okay, then. Okay, then you want to do 3 minutes?
Bingo.
Okay.
Don't make any special thing for me. But nice smiley face. Who did that? That was great.
But you're wearing neon, so we'll do it.
You should see when the batteries are.
All right. All right. Thank you very much. Okay. So, Madam Clerk, hold on 1 second. Let's just make sure everyone's ready. Yes. Yeah, we have some people sitting down on the and standing. Do we have any more chairs?
There's one right next to Sam.
And Sam's actually really nice. He doesn't bite. So, and there's two up here. So do you guys want to come and sit up here? We'll move it. All right. I'd like to call this meeting to order, and we're going to start with the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'd love for Mike Higgin to lead us in the pledge. He's shaking his head.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes, Madam Mayor. Breckus, absent at this time. Dewar.
Here.
Delgado. McKenzie.
Here.
Jardin. Here. Bobzien.
Here.
Chivi.
Here.
You do have a quorum, Madam Mayor.
All right, thank you very much. Item A3, Madam Clerk.
Our first public comment is from Sam Dene, followed by Katie Calling.
She gave me 3 minutes, by the way, Ashley. Thank you. Okay, now we're good to go. Sam Dene, I'm the Encyclopedia of Reno Government. Sam DNA Dene, the DNA of Reno Government. She's nodding her head, she knows it. I'm an Air Force Academy graduate. I've been around, I've flown F-4 Phantoms and B-52 bombers defending our nation, and I'm the best national anthem protester in the history of the world, and they all saw it last week and the week before and the week before, but I didn't have my guitar with me. I was down working out, just happened to be in the neighborhood, and lucky me, I drove by, and here's a city council meeting. What are the chances? My favorite thing. It's even almost as much fun as sipping tequila. No, not that much fun. At any rate, for those who don't know, there's a lot of new faces. I'm the driving force. You can ask Colonel Kazmierski. I'm the driving force for 92% of the good things about Reno, starting with Bernie Mann when they wanted to shut it down 10 years ago. I was the only person who came to the podiums over county and said, don't shut it down. They didn't shut it down. Now it's one of the best operations in Reno. I saved the Air National Guard when they wanted to get fighter planes, and I told them to get cargo planes, and they got cargo planes. We still have a wonderful Air National Guard, which might not even be here if not for Sam. And then there's Tesla. I was a driving force that helped bring Tesla here, but I'm really beginning to wonder about that one, ladies and gentlemen. I really am. And here today, mainly to talk about the number one enemy of Reno, Nevada. And she's grimacing. She thinks, uh-oh. The number one, no, it's not the city council. It's not the bureaucrats. It's not the poobahs and potentates who sign the checks, pull the strings, snatch the bodies, and steal the votes. It's not them. No, it's the media mouses. It's the media mouses that call them Channel 248 and the Reno Gazette Journal media mouses. And then she's smiling back there. She even knows that the media mouses smile when I call them media mouses. What's with that? Maybe you think it's a compliment. It's not. By the way, so I used to think that I was the number one enemy of the media mouses. Well, I'm right. I am by far the number one enemy. I'm the most feared 160-pound senior citizen, most feared person in the community by the media mouses. But now, you know, the bottom line is the media just does not like Reno. That's all it comes down. Does not like Reno. I'm saying it right there. The media, 2-4, Channel 2-4, the radio 2, excuse me, do not like Reno. Now let's take this thing right here. A newspaper report I see right here. Oh no, here's the tax thing for the schools. They're saying, new poll says, the Washoe County citizens looking forward to a great big new tax right there. Washoe County looking for citizens looking forward to a great big tax. What kind of headlines is that? Is anybody looking forward to that tax? Put your hands up. I don't. Oh, ha! 1, 2, 3. Okay, I know three. How many got here? 120 people. 4, 5, 6, 7. Eight hands. Anybody else? Here we go. At any rate, now they don't even like the casinos. Here are the Caranos, the Eldorado, the biggest financial deal in the history of Northern Nevada. $2 billion transaction by the Eldorado and Caranos. And what do they get? Five paragraphs right in there. That's all they get. Next thing you know, they won't be writing about them at all.
Madam Mayor, our next public comment is from Katie Colling, followed by Paul Lennart.
All right, I'm going to give you the option to, if you want to take 3 minutes or 1 minute. Okay.
Excuse me?
We were going to start out doing 1 minute. Sam had to leave, so he wanted to exercise his 3 minutes. So if you have to leave too, you can have that option.
Okay, thank you.
I don't want to cut you short.
Is this okay if I move this? Thank you. I moved it last time. I apologize. Three works, please. So I'm really excited to hear that you guys are actually having a meeting about this. However, this is not the first meeting. We've had many. There's a housing plan from 2008 that has a really amazing ideas in it. I suggest you guys read it. I have a list of several things from that plan that we would love to see implemented and used in our city. Just to name a few, provide information to the NABs about housing rehabilitation and available funding sources, leasing land, trust fund for affordable housing, mixed income policies, donating land to nonprofits and community groups. All of those things are in your paperwork. You've already done the work. I'm really excited to hear you're going to hear basic information today about how the fact that you need to have $18 an hour in order to afford a two-bedroom house in this town. These are things you should already know, but I'm glad you're learning them today. I'm going to leave you with your 2008 housing plan. I'm going to give this to her. I've got all my notes, including some options you're not talking about, like consensus-based housing, more case managers instead of mercenaries along the highway. That really pissed me off. Smoother permitting processes for all the parties, and then helping people contribute to the HMIS system so you have accurate information about the people living in hotels and motels downtown. I also have our presentation that we would like to present to you guys at your next affordable housing meeting. I'll leave this with her as well. And I hope you guys read it and take our ideas seriously. And it's really upsetting to see that the NDOT hired mercenaries to clear the highway. It's really upsetting to see that the construction finished at the old bus station included taking away the benches where people sit and putting in anti-homeless spikes and waves so they couldn't sit down anymore. And it's really upsetting that the RTC is using eminent domain to take over the co-ed and the Sundance in order to tear it down and make a new bus stop, because we don't have enough of those in downtown Reno, apparently. And they're tearing down housing instead of helping people. I really hope we spend money on helping human beings, Holy cow. Does anybody have any questions? No? Didn't think so.
Madam Mayor, our next public comment is from Paul Lennart, followed by Shalise Patak.
I'll only need the 1 minute. I assume that the purpose of restricting it to 1 minute is that we can then counterpunch after the presentation.
There
good.
You go.
I'm a better counterpuncher. Okay. Thank you. But I did want to say one thing, which was I understand that you had some other things to deal with, and that's why the public housing question was not addressed some weeks back. I'm glad you have resolved that particular matter. And he's gone. But I did want to mention that, happy as I am that you are having this public meeting and that we are airing a variety of views on the question, I have to note that before a plan or a solution has been even put forward, much less implemented, once again, there's been an act of class war against the homeless in this city. The removal of benches when there's nowhere else to go. That's low. That's real low. I can't come up there and take your seat away, or yours. Or yours, but you can take theirs. I don't know a whole lot about what you'd call class, but the upper and middle can all kiss my ass.
Madam Mayor, our next public comment is from Shalise Patak, followed by Stephanie Michaels.
Hello. So as you just heard, my name is Shalise. I'm a little nervous. I've never done this before. I have lived in Reno my entire life. I'm 34 years old. I'm raising my two beautiful daughters here in Reno. I've prided myself on this city for a very long time. And when I hear outsiders say negative things about Reno, I always try to remind them about the positive things about Reno. And lately, I haven't been able to do that much. And it really makes me sad. I'm also on the board of directors with the Reno Initiative for Shelter and Equality, and I've been doing that for 2.5 years. And I've been out in the streets and helping feed people for 2.5 years now and hearing their stories. And to hear that NDOT could potentially hire armed guards to move these people, where? Where are we moving them? Where do we expect them to go? We have one shelter that's overrun, and they do a good job with what they have. But if somebody tells you, here's an apple, and you have to go through this hoop and crawl through this window and go through this other hoop, and then you can have the apple, but shouldn't you be entitled to the apple to begin with? We shouldn't have to go through all of these hoops. It shouldn't be a difficult decision, and we should not become a cold-hearted city. This is not who Reno is, and I don't want to give up hope, and I'm starting to. Thank you.
Stephanie Michaels, followed by Jim Galloway.
Hope you don't mind taking the moment to introduce my granddaughter to democracy. My name is Steffi Michaels. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am very, very... I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I thought I was. Is that better? Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very glad to see that you're talking about affordable housing. Jade and I are the face of not the homeless, thank the gods. I went through that already. I spent time in living in my car, and it's no fun. But I'm now raising my granddaughter. We live on disability. Believe it or not, this state says that we're rich. So they won't give us assistance except for health care for her, for which I'm very, very grateful. But this town desperately needs, I mean, I grant you they need help for the homeless, but then we desperately need homes that we can afford. When you're going out there and you're seeing $1,500 a month, that leaves about $15 maybe for food if you can pay your utilities. So please, please, please think about us and help us get, there are some Section 52 homes, I believe. We need a lot more of them. There's a big move downtown and elsewhere to build really pretty expensive homes and condos and whatnot, and that's grand. But remember, we're out here too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Galloway, followed by Don Tatro.
Good afternoon. Thank you for listening to me. I don't want to be a downer on affordable housing. We need affordable housing. But I just want to make a comment that the city also needs a great downtown. And so what we need to do is increase the disposable income of the people downtown so we can bring businesses in. We need some high-rises downtown. The need for affordable housing should be spread out throughout the city. We don't want to concentrate it all downtown. So please just keep that in mind. Make sure everyone has the ability to have housing, but let's get downtown Reno the core market rate. Thank you.
Don Tatro, followed by Donna Klontz.
Hi, my name is Don Tatro with the Builders Association of Northern Nevada, and I just wanted to come up and thank you quickly for having this. This is a critical need in the community. The Builders Association wants to be a part of the solution. We actively want to engage. We have a plethora of resources, including members who work in the affordable housing arena and reports from the National Association of Home Builders. So however we can be a resource, please reach out to us. And again, thank you for having this.
Great. Thank you.
Donna Klontz, followed by George Foster.
The senior champion.
Good afternoon, Council and Mr. City Manager. I'm Donna Klontz. I live here in Reno. I'm chair of the Reno Senior Citizen Advisory Committee, and we too are concerned about the housing issues that are facing all of us. The number of seniors in our community is larger than many cities. We're glad we've got that powerful group of folks that are 50 and older here in our town. About a third of our population is in that senior category for all kinds of things. We know that poverty's up for our elders. People over 65 living below poverty more than doubled during the recession here, from 6,000 people to over 13,000 people. So those folks are the folks that especially are in need of the housing issues that you're going to be talking about today. We know that the people that are in, there are a lot of seniors in our shelters. There are a lot of them in the low-income housing, but as many speakers have said, we need more. That's a huge group of folks that just having a roof over their head so they can take care of their families is what keeps them going. So we, the Senior Citizen Advisory Committee, are having our joint meeting on October 5th from 3 to 5 at McKinley Arts Center, and we'll have a couple of speakers as well on housing issues, especially for seniors, and we're inviting the community to come join us for that. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Madam Mayor, our last public comment is from Mike Thornton.
Good Madam Mayor, council members, thank you for having this meeting today, and thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak. I don't think I'm going to be able to make it under 1 minute, but I'll try. Based upon a statement that Councilmember Delgado made at a previous meeting, that perhaps the council hasn't effectively communicated its commitment to affordable housing and socially equitable development, my suggestion is that the Reno City Council craft and pass a resolution similar to that of Seattle's resolution number 31577. Passed in May 2015, entitled, quote, a resolution confirming that the City of Seattle's core value of race and social equity is one of the foundations on which the comprehensive plan is built, end quote. Seattle's comprehensive plan toward a sustainable Seattle is their 20-year vision and roadmap for Seattle's future. The four values of Seattle's comprehensive plan are community, developing strong connections between a diverse range of people and places, environmental stewardship, protect and improve the quality of our global and local natural environment, economic opportunity and security, a strong economy and a pathway to employment is fundamental to maintaining our quality of life, and social equity. Limited resources and opportunities must be shared, and the inclusion of underrepresented communities in decision-making processes is necessary. I have a copy of the resolution that I will provide to your clerk. Passing such a resolution would communicate in a clear and concrete manner that the Reno City Council is committed to achieving socially equitable development and creating a thriving city for all. Most everyone understands that achieving these goals are difficult and that it takes the entire community working together to be successful. However, a clear statement from our City Council proclaiming that social equity is a core value of our redevelopment plan would go a long way towards providing the necessary leadership and rallying point, as well as inspiring the confidence of the residents of Reno and that their elected officials are working on behalf of their interests. Perhaps something like this has already been done. If so, it would be helpful if the council reminded us of it. Nobody expects city government to have all the answers. In fact, local organizations, RISE being one of them, have ideas and proposals to contribute to this effort. What we do need from you is leadership, with clear communication and transparent action, so the people of Reno can be effective partners in creating the type of city that we want and that will benefit all of our people. Thank you very much for your time and consideration of this suggestion.
Thank you.
Madam Mayor, I have no further public comment from persons who wish to speak at this time.
All right, thank you very much. Then we will move forward with A4, approval of the agenda. May I get a motion? I have a motion, do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? The motion carries unanimously. All right. Item B1, presentations. All you, I think. No problem.
So, Madam Mayor, before Eric steps up, I just wanted to put some context to this meeting. This is a council workshop. The purpose of the meeting is for the council to gather information about this very important subject matter. So we're not requesting as staff that you make any decisions or provide us with any specific direction. However, you can certainly provide direction as you see fit. But again, the purpose of this meeting was for all to have a common understanding of what our situation is, what programs are available, what things the city is doing, so that when you get to the point where you need to make some public policy decisions, you have that background information.
Yep. Great, fantastic.
Thank you, City Manager Thomas. It's a pleasure to be with you today, Council, and I apologize, I'm losing my voice a little bit here. First off, this is very impressive. The group that we have assembled here today, Council and those in the audience, represent a very wide spectrum of persons who are interested in affordable housing. Because affordable housing is not a simple item that you can discuss in 5 minutes and be done with. It's very broad reaching. And in particular, let me say that every person in this room, whether it be those here assembled in the audience, whether it be the council on the dais, has a personal interest in affordable housing. It may be something as noble as caring for the chronically homeless, or perhaps the working class, or it may be a rather self-centered interest, such as just having enough money to go on vacation or to put a child through college. But regardless, affordable housing affects every single person that lives on this planet. And so that said, the specific issue or the specific purpose of today's workshop is to get a better grasp on this ever-evolving issue and to broaden our understanding such that we can engage in an educated and productive dialogue on the topic. So to that end, within this workshop, we're going to be adopting a different set of rules or procedures than we typically would use in a presentation. And so in our first hour, we're going to have a series of presentations that introduce this topic, specifically the issues of affordable housing, the tools and opportunities that are available, and some of the current, an update on the current projects that we are undertaking, and the affordable housing opportunities that have come about as the result of the leadership of this council and previous councils. Following that, we're going to have a 10-minute discussion on the challenges associated with affordable housing, and also we'll have a break so that if we want to, you can get up, stretch your legs, you know, do whatever's necessary. To maximize the benefit of the panel discussion and those of our experts here today, we have a series of cardstock or blank cards that we're going to circulate to those who are here in attendance and also to the council members, because we're not going to be taking questions during the presentations. And so what we would like is for any of those who have questions of the panel members in particular to write down those questions, and we will go and we will collect them all, and we'll go through them, and we'll combine similar questions. And then when we have our panel discussion at the very end, we will then take questions off of those cards. That's the best way to get as many people heard as possible in the short period of time that we have. Then following that, of course, we will turn the time back over to the council, and we'll have our second public hearing or public comment process, in which anybody who didn't feel like they were heard can come and speak again on whatever topic they may have. So at this time, I'm going to turn the time over to Matt Prosser. I'm sure that you will recognize him. He's been here numerous times. And we've asked each speaker to introduce themselves, talk a little bit about themselves, what their expertise is, why they're here today. And so I'm just going to turn over to Matt, and we'll go from that point.
Good afternoon. It's good to see you all again. excuse me. I'm at the tail end of a cold, so excuse me. I'm Matt Prosser. I'm a vice president with Economic and Planning Systems. EPS is a land use economics consulting firm. I'm based out of Denver, but we have four offices, one in Denver, obviously, Los Angeles, Oakland, and Sacramento. As you know, I'm working with you all on your master plan update, as well as supporting PUMA on the Downtown Action Plan. EPS also has a strong practice area in affordable housing. We're working with a number of communities nationally, developing strategies for cities to help them address affordable housing needs. Recently active in Denver, Nashville, Portland, Park City, and a lot of communities throughout the West. And I think this is a great time for you all to have this discussion, in that you're developing your master plan, because oftentimes these discussions don't overlap. And I think I'll talk about this later, but I think the master plan is one tool to help address some of the needs. And so I think the timing is very good. So what I'm going to do today is try to provide a really basic framework of understanding of general terms related to affordable housing, a little bit on national trends, and then some insight into what we found in Reno in terms of what affordable housing issues there are, to help to kind of start the conversation as we dig into more depth with our other presenters. So first, sort of just definitions of affordable housing. So HUD defines affordable housing as the ability of a household to spend no more than 30% of their income on housing. And most often that's referred to by a term called cost burden. So if a household is cost burden, that means that they're spending more than 30% of their income on housing. Now, what that means in terms of an affordable rent or for sale home price level, that varies greatly depending on a community. And really the issues, the affordable housing issues, are similar in a lot of communities across the nation, but do vary greatly depending on the local demographics, the economic base, and the local conditions. And so it's important to understand, generally, what we talk about is making sure that households can afford housing. But what that means in terms of your demographic groups, that can vary. And so we'll get into that going forward. So most generally in affordable housing kind of lingo, area median income is used to as sort of the starting point for describing what different income groups there are and their levels of affordability. And so HUD establishes an area median income for MSAs throughout the country. And so for the Reno Sparks MSA, the area median income, household income, is $54,000. And so HUD uses that definition of median income to establish the parameters for a variety of federal programs that are aimed at providing housing for low-income residents. And so they base that off of a percentage of your area median income. So we're going to talk a lot about things like 30% of area median income or 50% of area median income. And that's really referring to this overall median income and a percentage of less of that in terms of what demographic groups fit into that income level. And then we also will talk about the idea of rental and ownership affordability. And so to calculate rental affordability, we're usually talking about pre-tax income for a household times 30% divided by 12 months minus utilities. And that is how we calculate what a maximal affordable rent is for a household for different income levels. And for ownership affordability, it's the same sort of process. But instead of rent, you're looking at the mortgage plus, or you're looking at what HOA dues, taxes, or insurance are to back those out of your income to figure out what a maximum affordable mortgage payment is. And so that's sort of the parameters of how we calculate what's affordable based on different income levels. So in HUD terms, there's three main levels that they refer to most often: an extremely low income, and that's referring to households that earn less than 30% of the area median income. And so for the Reno Sparks MSA, that's $18,000 for a household of 2.5 people. So that's an average household size. That's why we use 2.5. Very low income refers to 30-50% of AMI, and low income would be 50-80% of AMI, and you can see the different levels. And we'll walk through in a minute where Reno's demographics fall within these income levels. So what are we seeing nationally? Well, what we're seeing is affordable housing is a big issue for a lot of communities in the nation, and you're not alone in that. And a lot of that has to do with the changes in housing costs versus the changes in income. And as you may know, incomes in the US have been fairly flat or stagnant for the last 10, 15 years. And then during the same time, housing costs have grown at a much higher rate. Even with the major economic recession in 08 and 09, once we've sort of reset in a lot of communities, those housing costs have ratcheted back up to equal levels or even higher than they were prior to the housing bubble. And so this is sort of the essence of why a lot of communities are talking about affordable housing, is that the income that residents have is going a lot less further in terms of affording housing. So housing is a complex topic, and it can quickly get very confusing. And so I think the goal is to make sure that you're continuously thinking about what can you influence and what's in your purview as a city council, as a city, as a community, and not getting hung up on larger issues that you really don't have control on. Let's make sure we focus on what's in your purview. And then clearly stating your priorities and goals. Who do we want to help, and how many people are we trying to address? And what is important to the community? And I mentioned the master plan earlier. I think that's a great place to put clearly out what you think your priorities are. What are your goals for affordable housing? And that way the community knows, and it's in your growth plan. And then lastly, it's thinking about leverage. So what resources do you have, and how can you use those? Use them. And so for a city like Reno, you have financial resources, you have, CDBG funds, you have home funds that are provided by the federal government, as opposed to potential other revenue sources that you could allocate to affordable housing. You have regulatory tools, you have zoning, you have development standards, things like that. You have a housing authority, you have partners, you have many partners. That's one thing I've learned in our time looking at these issues in Reno is there's a lot of active partners now doing a lot of great things. And so how can you help foster relationships and help them do their work is really a point of leverage that you have. And lastly, it comes down to political will. I mean, what is your priority and how hard are you willing to fight for that? And so really, those are the things you need to think about in terms of the tools to work with. And ultimately, success means aligning your actions and goals with the places that you have leverage, and so that you're trying to achieve something where you actually have a tool to help achieve that. So what direction to take? I think it's really important to realize that there is not one housing solution. There isn't one silver bullet that's going to solve the problems. A lot of communities we work with try to quickly find that one solution that's going to solve it and sort of move on, but it's going to take multiple different ideas, and then they evolve. Your issues are going to evolve. Your needs are going to evolve, and understanding that is important. And so, again, it's what are we trying to solve? What are the vehicles of leverage? And then how strong is the political will? So when we look at Reno, what does the world look like in terms of housing and affordable housing? And so a concept that we like to use to help kind of illustrate how the community fits is the idea of a housing bridge. And so you can see this here. It's different sort of pie pieces that refer to different segments of AMI, from 0 to 30% AMI all the way to 200 plus. And it gives you an indication of the household income for each group. And so when you think about a housing bridge, there's your community spread along this bridge. And the reality is people are going to move back and forth along the bridge. They're not going to be necessarily stuck in certain pies all the time. So you got to consider that. That's going to change over time. So where we are today, so I've provided the percent of households that are in each of these AMI wedges. And I'm going to go through some specific ones in a minute. So don't feel like you need to absorb this completely in the 2 seconds I'm going to talk about it. But this shows you that for the most part, I don't think it's extremely bifurcated, but I think that the community is somewhat bifurcated in terms of a large portion of folks that are on sort of the lower income range, that under an 80%, that's 48% of the households in the city are under that 80% AMI level. And then you have a large portion that are sort of in the higher income. And so it's important to understand that you have diverging needs for different groups. And so what trends are we seeing in Reno? Well, we're starting to see the same national trend appear. I think that the recession, the housing bubble, was especially impactful in Reno, and it has taken longer for this community to sort of reset and regrow in terms of its housing prices and sort of recovering than other places in the nation. And so you're starting to feel this divergence between income and housing costs that other communities are a few years ahead of because they recovered quickly. And largely that's due to the large crash. And it really illustrates this chart and the national one, that just how out of whack prior to the recession incomes and housing were. And I'm not necessarily saying that the trends growing are leading to another recession, but it shows you that we're starting to see another disconnect. And there's things that we can do to address that. So looking at Reno in terms of your affordable housing issues, the consolidated plan that you do every 5 years that dictates what you spend your federal CDBG and home funds on, identified cost burden as the biggest housing problem. And in our analysis, we agree with that. And so cost burden is really a major issue for your rental households. As you can see here, this chart shows the percent of households in each of those AMI groups that are paying more than 30% of their income on housing. You can see from the 80% of AMI down that it's an issue for most households, especially the really low income households. Now, that's true in most communities, but I think that in Reno, this is really the heart of the affordable housing issue. And so when we think about what that means, we like to compare what rental rates are to what these different income groups can afford in terms of rent. And so you see the red line there, that's the median rental rate for the city based on the census in 2014. So it's a bit out of date. And as you know, your rental costs have been growing pretty strongly in the last 3 or 4 years. I think they're up, I want to say 10 to 15% over the last 2 or 3 years. And so this is likely a little bit higher. And so you can see is that for households that earn 30% of AMI, there's a gap of, you know, about $300 per month between what they can afford to pay for housing and what housing actually costs. And there's also a gap for 30 to 50% of AMI. And so far, 50 to 80, there isn't necessarily that gap. But as rental rates grow, it become more of an issue. And so to us, this is where a lot of your focus should be, is sort of this 0 to 50, 0 to 60% of AMI rental. It should be a priority, or at least where we think that there are needs. And so I'm going to walk you through each AMI kind of grouping to try to help put a little bit of a face to whom some of these folks are and help understand what their needs are. So it's a little bit more, you have more of an understanding than just, you know, sort of a nerdy percentage term. And so when we're thinking about 0 to 30% of AMI, these are households that earn less than $18,000 a year. And for the most part, these are households that are on fixed incomes. They're potentially single earners in the accommodations and food service industry, or they're homeless or near homeless populations. Or retired, yes. Predominantly renters, 78%. I would mention, you know, a lot of that, the owner population here are likely seniors and retired folks that that are homeowners, but do, you know, are not earning a higher income because they are retired. Their needs, subsidized housing. A lot of times there are people that need wraparound services to support their housing. So whether that's mental health services and other things to help them, homeless prevention, transitional housing to move from homeless to permanent housing, and housing close to services and jobs. And I think it's really a lot of the focus of this group is trying to make sure that people that need services are able to live near them and not creating extra burdens to access these. And so in terms of the overall pie of how many people are fit in this, 17% of households in the city fall into this group. Next, when we look at 30 to 50% of AMI, these are households that earn between 18 and 27,000. A single earner, somebody working in the retail industry, this is where they would fit. And mostly renters, 62%. And so what do they need? As we can see, there's a gap in between what they can afford to pay in terms of rent and what the average or median rental rates are. So rental assistance and potentially subsidized housing are needed here. Close proximity to access, or proximity and access to jobs, that's a key. Reducing, there's different components to affordability. There's the housing cost, but also transportation. And reducing transportation costs can really help income or households in this income group really maintain affordability. And then assistance with home repair and maintenance. There are a fair amount of folks that are lower income that are homeowners still. And as their home ages, they need assistance with keeping up with the maintenance. And they might not have the access to capital and the funds necessary to stay with that. And so you can use some of your funding and your programs to help address issues related to that. Next, looking at 50 to 80% of AMI. So these are households that earn between 27 and 43,000 per year. So this is a single earner that earns about average wage in Washoe County. Most of these folks are renters, but there are a sizable portion that are owners. And what do they need? They need close and reliable access to jobs. Sometimes they need access to higher quality neighborhoods, you know, not necessarily being stuck in sort of a lower income neighborhood, but being able to, you know, be in a mixed neighborhood that has a variety of people and incomes to help build their social capital. Assistance with home repair and maintenance, that's another key thing for these lower income groups. And then potentially home buyer assistance. As you start to get to 70 to 80% of AMI, you start to get to a point where home ownership becomes more feasible, and helping these folks get into a for sale home is a place you could focus. And a lot of communities start to focus, if they have programs related to home ownership, they start to focus around that 80% AMI or higher. And so this group, it's about 16% of households. And so they're pretty equal wedges for that 0 to 30, that 30 to 50, and a 50 to 80. They're all pretty equally in size and all have different needs. And then lastly, we're going to talk about 80 to 100% of AMI. So these are households that earn $43,500 to $65,000 per year. This is the single earner in manufacturing or logistics. So a lot of what your job growth is right now, this is where the a single owner in those industries would fall in terms of their income level. And this is a fairly even split between owners and renters. And so what do we need here? Increased housing options. I think that's a key. And I'll get into that more in a section in a minute. And it's something that we talked to you about last time I saw you in terms of the master plan work that we did. Again, access to higher quality housing, assistance with home repair, again, and home buyer assistance. So 17% of households fit into this group. So I mentioned the master plan, so I want to sort of clearly state where I think the master plan can play a role in this. It cannot address all issues, and nor should it. And so the places where I think it can help is clearly stating the goals and policies related to affordable housing for the city, being that clear calling card of this is what's important to us. The next thing is providing Reno's economic development strategy. What are the goals, policies, and actions that you want to carry forward to help diversify your income and help raise the incomes of all residents? Planning for a diversity of housing, that I'll get into that in the next slide. Better connecting housing stocks, the housing stock to employment areas. I know this is an issue for Mr. McKenzie. Making sure that there's housing that's affordable next to where people work. And then lastly, guiding Reno's actions and investments related to housing. So we did a large study related to housing needs and demand as we presented this to you and the Planning Commission back in July. And so what we found, the major takeaways were that Reno has an oversupply of land or lots planned for single-family detached homes. And what we're finding is that single-family detached homes are increasingly not affordable to the average household or worker in Reno. However, smaller, more attached products are affordable, but there's just a lot less of them available. And that's an issue we're seeing nationally as well. We're seeing that a lot of that entry-level for-sale home development has gone away because it's becoming increasingly harder and harder for developers to feasibly develop a detached product that's affordable at that lower income. And so you can see the average new home sale price for a single-family home is $420,000, at least in 2014, 2015, and it's probably a little bit higher today. But when you look at a condo or townhome, it's about $250,000. And so this speaks to the need for the diversity of housing stock to help provide a diversity of options for residents to be able to afford. And so what are impactful master plan policy directions? I think clearly defining what Reno's definition of affordable housing is, what are the priorities, what the economic development strategy should be, and then what we can do as a community to diversify the housing stock. I think where the master plan can help provide for direction. But again, it's not the only thing that needs to be done to address affordable housing. So what are the takeaways? So what are the things I want to leave you with? So I think affordable housing is a growing problem nationally. So don't feel that you're alone in this. I mean, this is something that a lot of communities are dealing with. And there's a lot of interesting strategies that different communities are taking to address this. And so there's a lot to be learned from other places in the country. Reno's largest issue, at least in our opinion, is cost burden, and especially for renters earning less than 50% of AMI. We found that Reno has a strong network of people working on housing issues, especially for that really low income group where there's a really high need and really there's large gaps in terms of what's affordable and what these people can afford to pay. And so I think it's important to realize there's a lot going on, and I think focusing on how you can support these folks and their efforts is something that should be a priority. Again, it's a complex topic with a wide variety of potential approaches. So again, not one silver bullet will solve the issue. And then just leaving you with the thought of making sure you realize and you think about what's in your purview, what can we control as a city, and what leverage, what tools do we have to address that, and focusing there and not getting hung up on sort of broader issues that you can't necessarily solve as a city. So with that, thank you for your time, and I'm gonna pass it along. Sorry.
Hi there. My name is Stacy Jurado Miller, and I am a supportive housing developer with a national company called the Vecino Group. The Vecino Group is based in Springfield, Missouri, but we have done work across the country. And I would like to talk with you today about affordable housing in general, how we create it, and most importantly, the people that it serves. I think that it was really timely and relevant that you opened with public comment and that you had people present the face of affordable housing, which really is central to all of this. When we hear the phrase affordable housing, I think what people tend to think of are the worst case examples. You know, there's these iconic failures in affordable housing that tend to, that can represent and shape public perception. And so I think as a city and as a council, as you begin to think about affordable housing, you've already taken the first step as a city, which is being open to affordable housing and not opposing it. As we move from state to state and city to city, I can assure you that that is not always the case. So congratulations to the city of Reno for not being there and for recognizing that the failures of the affordable housing system are not what affordable housing is. Today, I would primarily like to talk about the type of affordable housing that the Vecino Group develops, which is Section 42, low-income housing tax credit housing. This is affordable housing that is funded by the federal government as well as state governments, and it is meant to serve individuals at 60% AMI and below. And when I said that I am a supportive housing developer, what that means is that my primary focus is serving those individuals who are at 30% AMI or below, people who would struggle to obtain and maintain housing if not for associated services. So in talking about avenues of funding, I think that one of the opportunities for you as a city to recognize is that as developers look at how they can help solve the affordable housing crisis in Reno, I would like to talk you through how we as developers look at various funding sources when we're analyzing a situation. And so we know that there's this toolbox of funding sources. And so as we approach a city or a new state, we say what's available in this city or state that's going to make the deal financially viable. And so, as I mentioned, low-income housing tax credit is a program that began in 1986, really as an alternative to public housing as it had existed previously, which was affordable housing used to be developed and maintained entirely by the government. And as we've seen in the public perception of the projects, it didn't always work. And so the Section 42 tax credit program was created as a combination of public funds and private developers, as well as investors who purchase the tax credits. The 10-second explanation of the low-income housing tax credit program is that every state has a pool of money. It's administered by a state agency. And how they allocate that money is a competitive process. Developers put together affordable housing deals, and then they compete for the funds. And once the funds are allocated, those tax credit dollars are sold to major corporations who use them to offset their tax burden. And that money is put back into the deal. And that allows the developer to subsidize the rents and create a quality affordable housing product. One of the true successes of this program is that it also provides for ongoing maintenance. The developer is responsible for yearly inspections, and if they don't pass, if they aren't maintaining the housing at an acceptable level, then the credits can be removed, the investor loses, everybody's angry. So that doesn't happen. There's various levels of oversight. And I think that's why it's such a successful government program. Additionally, developers also look for supplemental funding sources to make the deal financially strong. And without some supplemental form of funding, Section 42 tax credits alone can't create permanent supportive housing. They can only create affordable housing that serves individuals at 60% AMI. In order to serve the people at 30% AMI, you need additional forms of funding. And so that can take many forms. In states that have strong historic tax credit programs, that's an option. I believe here in Nevada, you have a 20% reimbursement for historic projects. Housing trust fund dollars are key. city funds are essential. Generally, when a developer is looking at a city, they'll sit down with the city officials. They'll pitch the deal that they're proposing. They'll make sure that it's reflective of the needs of the community. And then, especially if it's a 4% bond deal, where there's generally more of a funding gap, and the benefits of a 4% deal are that it's less competitive. And so your odds of getting that deal funded are much stronger. So bond deals could be a great opportunity for the city of Reno to see housing plans realized, but more than likely the city could increase the odds of seeing that happen if you were able to apply some home funds or some CDBG funds to the process. So that's one thing that developers will often look to a city for, is some funding assistance to help bridge that gap. Additionally, you can often apply for funding from private foundations to help close the gap and be able to serve extremely low-income individuals. When we talk about supportive services and creating permanent supportive housing, it is essential to be able to get the rents even lower than are allowed for in general affordable housing. So if we're serving people at 60% AMI, we're able to get the rents down to a certain level, and that's a true asset to those people. But when we're dealing with special needs populations, the chronically homeless, the mentally ill, homeless veterans, youth aging out of foster care, some form of additional rental assistance is necessary, and you also have to have a funding source to pay for the on-site supportive services. So for supportive housing, we have a separate toolkit that we look for in a city and that or a state, and that might be availability of VASH vouchers. Those serve veterans specifically. Shelter plus care vouchers, those are often earmarked for individuals with mental illness or substance abuse issues. Continuum of care, which of course as a city, every city has a continuum of care and they often have some dollars. Project-based vouchers, this is huge. This for me as a developer is the holy grail of being able to make a project work, is if a public housing authority is willing and able to project-based vouchers. That's huge. And again, private foundations. So what does all of this look like? I think this, you know, it's important to not just show bar graphs, but give actual examples of what quality affordable housing looks like. This first example I'm going to show you is a 100% special needs project in the city of St. Louis. And this is a deal that we did in conjunction with the largest homeless service provider in the state, as well as the Department of Mental Health. And it involved both federal low-income housing tax credits, state low-income housing tax credits, state historic, and federal historic. So if you imagine the same deal in Nevada, you would be facing some obstacles as a developer because you wouldn't have that state LIHTC fund and your historic would be much lower. But this was a blighted and abandoned building that had sat vacant for 10 years. The Vecino Group believes very strongly that we're responsible not just for putting roofs over people's head, but for developing the type of housing that we ourselves would want to live in. So we hold ourselves to a really high standard as far as quality goes. And we also make sure to remember that every development we do is to serve the individuals who will live in it, and that there's not an us versus them, and I think that's an important mentality to keep in mind. So this is Daryl, and he's one of the veterans who lives at Freedom Place. And though Daryl came to Freedom Place homeless, I think it's also important to remember that once an individual is housed in quality supportive housing, they are no longer a homeless person in your community. And so while I absolutely agree that it's important to not concentrate affordable housing in an area, I think it's also important to remember that once you create quality permanent supportive housing, the stigma of what a homeless person looks like is no longer an issue, really. They'd become just any other community member, which is as it should be. My next example is called Hudson Art House, and this is in Troy, New York. And I think that this is a great example for the city of Reno to consider that you're not having to look at either or. It doesn't have to be you serve individuals at 80% or you serve individuals at 40%. Within one development, you can serve a mixed income population and solve various affordable housing needs. This again is a combination of federal and state low income housing tax credits, as well as federal and state historic. This is a $20 million deal. It also rehabbed in a blighted and abandoned building, and it provides on-site artistic resources to increase the creative presence in the community. And lastly, I have Bodie. Bodie is a true example of integration. This is a five-story multifamily community set to be built in Salt Lake City that will provide market rate units, low-income housing tax credit units, and units serving a variety of special needs populations. There's a set aside for the chronically homeless. There's one for individuals with persistent mental illness and for individuals with disabilities. And I think that this project shows that you can serve a variety of needs as long as you have the right service partnerships, a willingness from the city to accept an integrated approach, and creative funding. So in this one, we have some low-income housing tax credits, a permanent loan, that long acronym there with the OWHLF is actually home funds. And the RMP rebate represents a rebate from the electric company actually on each unit, small amount per unit, $1,100, but when you have an 80 unit development, that adds up. And then a chunk of the developer fee that is being deferred. And Bodie will open in a year and a half, and it's also a transit-oriented development. And here is the point in the presentation where we ask you to imagine the inspiring photos of best practice examples of affordable housing in Reno, Nevada. I think that's the opportunity today. And again, as a housing developer who works in a variety of states, I would encourage you to look at how to make it possible for people to develop quality affordable housing here. Thank you.
Great job. Very well done. Hi.
Do you need to take a breather? Move on? I was saying, do you need to take a breather or just move on?
No, I think, is everyone okay?
Okay.
I think we're good.
All right.
Yeah, I think that we're just going to go one by one so that we don't interrupt everyone else.
So I'm having trouble reading. Thank you, Madam Mayor and Council members. My name is Eric Novak. I'm from Praxis Consulting Group in Reno, and we're a development finance consulting firm. I also want to introduce Dr. Hillary Lopez and Jessica Bailey from Praxis, who are in the audience. Since 2004, Praxis has assembled the financing for and closed over 45 affordable housing developments in Nevada. That's over 3,500 units and $540 million of financing. Many of you are familiar with these developments in Reno, including Silver Sage Senior Residence, Neil Road Senior Apartments, St. Vincent's Residence, Crossroads, Moran Street Apartments, and most recently, we just closed Vintage at the Crossings, which is broke ground last week and is a 230-unit senior apartment community in the South Meadows on Old Virginia Road adjacent to the Super Walmart. I was asked to provide a local perspective on affordable housing. I want to first thank the council for scheduling this workshop. This is our daily work. We live and breathe housing, but we don't get a chance to contribute to the public policy discussion, so thank you. I also want to acknowledge some of the affordable housing developers that are in the audience. So Jim Sikeo and Dane Hilliard from Green Street Properties, and Chip Hobson from Silver Sage Manor, Inc. And they're the ones who actually take the risks, have the sleepless nights, and get these projects done. So we very much appreciate their work. You should have received three handouts in your package. And the first is a map and list of all the rent-restricted affordable housing in Washoe County. And I don't know if you see that one. Looks like this. This was, we had an affordable housing forum back in the spring, and there was a bus tour. The forum was sponsored by the Nevada Housing Division and the Federal Reserve of San Francisco, and we did a bus tour. And took folks around to see some of the affordable housing in this community. And I'll talk about the portfolio affordable housing inventory in a little while. The second handout are excerpts from publications from the National Low Income Housing Coalition, which is one of the premier advocacy organizations nationally pushing for more resources for affordable housing. The coalition releases an out-of-reach report annually that highlights the gap between household income and median rents. And right now in Nevada, the hourly wage needed to afford a median two-bedroom apartment is $18.26. So just to give you some sense of, they also point out that at the minimum wage, you'd have to work 89 hours a week in order to afford a median price. A two-bedroom apartment, or 2.2 people would have to work a full-time at minimum wage to afford an apartment. The coalition also releases a gap report each year, which details the gap between the number of units available to extremely low-income households and the number of extremely low-income households in the community. And Nevada has the distinction of being at the bottom of the entire country in terms of the amount of affordable housing available to extremely low-income households. So that in Nevada, a family of four at 30% median income, that's about $20,000 a year. There's about 17 units available for every 100 households. Where I moved here from Massachusetts, where it's 45 units are available for every 100 households of extremely low income. And in New York, 32 units, just to give you some sense. Reno, as Matt pointed out, Reno has a large population of service employees working at or near minimum wage and seniors on fixed income, and that have an extremely high housing cost burden. The final handout we'll get to later, but these are recommendations from the Barriers to Affordable Housing Development in Washoe County report that was prepared in 2008. So there was extensive process during the last housing boom where all your predecessors got together and commissioned a report, and there were 2 years of meetings, and there were a set of recommendations that were made at that time. And so the recommendations of the report are in the package, and a lot of the recommendations related to political barriers, financial barriers, regulatory barriers, they all still apply. So I think there's, I think 25 different recommendations in that report, a lot of them are still relevant. We haven't seen water rights go up to where they were in 2006, but a lot of the other issues are in terms of increasing construction costs and the difficulty of finding multifamily zone land are relevant. Back to the first handout. And so there's a map of affordable housing in Washoe County. And here's a breakout of, so what you may not know is that there's about 7,500 units of rent-restricted affordable housing in Washoe County. And so there's a long tradition of affordable housing developers in this community. I think we detail 94 projects. And all these units are affordable to households below 60% of median income, which is about $40,000 for a family of four in Reno. Many of the units, particularly those with rental assistance, are affordable to much lower income households. Here's the breakout of affordable units by type. As you can see, about two-thirds are family units, 23% senior restricted, and another 11% are SRO, single room occupancy, or housing for special needs populations. In addition to this, the Reno Housing Authority operates a Section 8 tenant-based voucher program that has probably another 2,000 vouchers. I don't know what it is currently, but just to give you a sense of that's our affordable housing inventory. And then these are the financing. So Stacy was talking about the different financing programs out there nationally. I want to assure you that we're using all of those programs in Nevada, that these are national programs. And so we use a lot of the same affordable housing resources. About three quarters of our affordable housing was funded using the low-income housing tax credit program. And of that, most of that was funded using bonds, tax-exempt bonds, and tax credits. And what's important about that is that the tax-exempt bond program basically ended in the mid-2000s. It was not financially feasible to do bond projects. And so most of the housing that was built, so 4,400 units of our affordable housing, that program became unworkable, and until very recently, I'll get to that. The remainder of the housing inventory consists of public housing, HUD-assisted housing like Section 202 and Section 811, and HUD legacy programs like the project-based Section 8 program. This housing, about 2,000 units, is extremely valuable to our community because it comes with rental assistance and can serve extremely low-income households who can't afford to live even in tax credit housing. So even the tax credit rents are higher than a lot of renters can afford in this community. Finally, many of the housing developments also receive funding from the Washoe County Home Consortium, and that projects come before the council time for that. And so these aren't mutually exclusive funding. The reason that this doesn't add up to 100% is because most housing projects have four or five different sources of funding to make them work. So I want to give you three examples of properties. The first one is this vintage at the Crossings. I just want to point out that Nevada also has some affordable housing resources that other states don't have. That we have a housing trust fund that was created in the early 1990s and is paid for with real estate transfer taxes. That was created by the state legislature. We also created a property tax exemption for developments that serve low-income households and have home funds in them. And so both those programs were created in the early 1990s, and I think the affordable housing community are indebted to those housing advocates from the early 1990s that made those programs happen, because we haven't seen a new influx of programs like that again. But those are the tools we work with to make affordable housing projects happen. So going to vintage at the Crossings. Just so you can get a sense of how these deals are structured, Ventures at the Crossing closed last week. As I said, it's just to go perspective, 230 unit, four-story elevator, new construction senior supportive housing. It's 100% affordable. It's located in what's a HUD small area difficult development area, and I'll get to that in a moment. And it's the first project in Northern Nevada that's using the Nevada Housing Division's growing affordable housing program. This. As I mentioned, we'd not been able to do a bond project in Northern Nevada since 2004. The reason for this is that from the mid-2000s on, the cost of building new housing were so high and the subsidy so narrow that the projects just didn't pencil. And two recent policy changes made a difference on that. And one is that HUD created these new areas called difficult development areas, or the new definition of difficult development areas that were located in high-income zip codes. Reno had never had difficult development areas before, and all of a sudden you have these zip codes that promote tax credit housing. They give a 30% boost in tax credits. And so what's great is that it's promoting affordable housing on a more dispersed basis outside of the urban core. And it's also helping bond projects go forward. The other is that the Nevada Housing Division, in order to promote more multifamily bond projects in the state, created the Growing Affordable Housing Program, or GAP, in order to restart the bond program for new construction projects. GAP provides below market rate and subordinate debt at extremely favorable terms using monies from NHD's own reserves. The Crossings project received $3 million a $3 million 3% loan, which bridged the financing gap. And it also received home funds from the Washoe County Home Consortium. So here's the sources of funds for the project. And I think what's striking is that the local monies, the gap funds and the home funds, add up to about $3.5 million, but they're leveraging about $37 million of national funds that we wouldn't have access to but for that small gap. And so every dollar of home funds and gap funds that went into this deal was leveraging about $10.45 of tax credit equity and bond debt. Next project, Leakin Way Apartments, which just had its grand opening the week before last. And it's a 9% tax credit project. 45 units, senior supportive housing, lots of community service space on site, an on-site service coordinator. 10% of the units are serving formerly homeless elderly households, and the project received an award of 5 project-based vouchers from the Reno Housing Authority under a new program that they've started in order to serve to integrate homeless housing with other affordable housing. I think it's great. The project also was built in a TOD. It has a set aside of 10% of the units for veteran households. And the financing on this is these are the projects that come to the council every year that you're probably most familiar with. And it's basically one project a year. So Nevada gets, our 9% tax credit program is very, very oversubscribed. Washoe County gets 15% of the tax credits for the state, which is about $650,000, and that's enough to finance one 40 to 45 unit apartment building every year. And so that's been our affordable housing program for the most part for the last 10 years. So it's, you know, that's why the bond program is so important and looking at other resources as well. I wanted to give you a sense of the financing structure of this. Again, it's mostly the 9% program, the tax credit funds about 75% of the project, and then we has a little bit of debt and then a whole bunch of other soft. This has Federal Home Loan Bank, Affordable Housing Program funds, Washoe County Home Consortium home funds. The final project, St. Vincent's Residence Crossroads, and this one was funded using 100% grant funds. And the project consists of 28 studio apartments. It was built by Catholic Charities of Northern Nevada. More recently, they collaborated with Washoe County Senior Services on the Crossroads program, and so that's sort of morphed into Crossroads since then. And the goal of Crossroads is to prevent relapses into homelessness and substance abuse and to reduce public costs associated with jail, hospital, and other emergency services. This project was really the Catholic Charities. I think at the time they wanted to tear down some of their housing that was in very poor shape. They didn't want to be in the slum landlord business. They wanted to operate quality housing. And they were able to do this with a lot of grant funds. So they put in some of their own money, but home funds. Sheila Leslie had helped push for a transitional housing fund in 2008, I think, legislative session. So there's a little bit of that money. Federal Home Loan Bank Affordable Housing Program funds. And see grants from Schwab Bank and the Redfield Foundation. And so the difficulty with doing 100% grant-funded projects is you get very few units out of it. So our home funds for Washoe County probably are $1.5 million for next year. So if we were just to use those to do a grant-funded project, that might give us 10 units of housing. And so that's the challenge there. On the positive side, you're not dealing with banks. There's a lot less regulatory constraints, but you don't get the leverage that you get with these other programs. So thank you. I think, okay. So you're taking it from here. Okay, thanks.
All right, great job. Fantastic.
Madam Mayor, I think you see that we've had a fairly august body assembled here today of experts, a panel of experts to address us and to give us advice and to help us become educated on the topic. At this point, we would like to take 10 minutes really quickly to talk about some of the barriers and some of the challenges that are associated with affordable housing here in our region. During that time also, we're going to be collecting the cards and we'll be coming back in 10 minutes with our panel of experts to address the issues that are raised on those cards.
Okay.
So if it's okay, we'll come and pick them up. So and then also we'll have, and if anyone needs to take a break, wants to step out, there's restrooms on the second floor. So head on out, we'll come back in 10 minutes. And
okay.
So, okay, oh, sorry, for those of you who weren't listening to me at the beginning of the presentation, excuse me, no. Basically, the cards are for us to write down any questions or issues we want to ask of the panel members.
Yeah.
And so when we have our panel discussion in 10 minutes, what we want to do is we want to get as many issues out to these experts in the brief period of time that we have. And so we're going to collect the cards, we'll consolidate questions that are similar, and then we'll actually ask these panel members to address those particular issues. So if you would, in the next 10 minutes, just write down your issues, the questions you have. We'll come around, we'll collect them, and then we'll move to that phase.
Okay, great.
Okay.
So I encourage everyone to use these.
Right.
Great. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. No, everybody in the audience who, yes, we've circulated cards and pens for everybody. So thank you.
All right, so we're gonna break for 10 minutes. I encourage everyone to write on your card. Really important to get feedback, ask as many questions as possible. And we will see you in 10 minutes. Hey, and you will take the cards. Perfect.
So I and Dez and another one of my assistants will come around and pick up your cards, so thank you.
Madam Clerk. All right, welcome back, everyone. I am just going to send it to Eric Jensen when he's ready.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the Council. It's great to be with you again. What I'd like to do is I'd like to start with our panel members and have each one of them go around, introduce themselves, give us 30 seconds on who they are and why we've invited them here today, assuming they know that. And then at that point, then I will move to some of these questions that we brought forth. So if we would start here, if you would, please.
My name is Nancy Brown. I work for Charles Schwab Bank. I've been with Charles Schwab Bank for 15 years. I've been working in the area of affordable housing. I have been involved with the Reno Area Alliance for 15 years. I'm on their steering committee. We're one of the providers, or one of the only providers, of access to the Federal Home Loan Bank AHP funds. So we've been involved with a lot of different projects locally. We do invest in low-income tax credits. And we have provided grants to various organizations to build the capacity around affordable housing. So we've been engaged, and we'll continue to stay very engaged in affordable housing needs of our communities.
Hi, I'm Michael Holliday. I'm the Chief Financial Officer for the Nevada Housing Division. I've been with the division for a couple of years, and I was with the Nevada Rural Housing Authority before that. So I specialize basically in the bond and 4% tax credit sides of the division's programs, but also work with the low-income housing tax credits.
Good afternoon. I'm CJ Manthe, the Administrator for the Nevada Housing Division. And I've been in affordable housing for about 13 years. So I don't know if that's unlucky, 13. But I love what I do, and I love the partners that we work with. The Nevada Housing Division, as Michael mentioned, we're involved in a number of different funding sources that help to make affordable housing a reality. And as I always tell people, we have the easy job. We typically provide financing, and our private sector and nonprofit partners do all the heavy lifting with the development. And so we like to work with our local jurisdictions as well to make sure that we're meeting the needs of the local communities. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Amy Jones. I'm with the Reno Housing Authority. I'm the executive director. I've been there about 11 years now. We administer the Housing Choice Voucher Program, the public housing, and also HUD-VOSH. So we provide that housing subsidy to those low-income families.
Good afternoon. Tony Ramirez. I'm the director of the Reno HUD office. I've been in Reno now for about just over 12 and a half years, and I've actually got to see the last peak in the housing prices, the bubble, and now pop, and now the bubble rising again, or at least housing prices rising again. And as Eric alluded to, a lot of those same issues that we were talking about back in 2004, 2006 are back again. So we do have a good foundation to build upon. My role here with HUD is basically to provide technical assistance as needed and make sure that the HUD dollars are going towards the community's needs. So thank you.
I'm Brian Burris, the Residential Program Manager of Supportive Services and Housing at Northern Nevada Adult Mental Health Services. And I'm also the chairperson for the Reno Area Alliance for the Homeless. And so I'd be happy to speak to any of the numbers that the Reno Area Alliance for the Homeless has been gathering and submitting to HMIS, or I can talk about the variety of services we offer through NAMS. Thank you.
I'm Matt Prosser with EPS again. And we've already introduced ourselves, but.
Housing developer with the Vecino Group.
Eric Novak with Praxis Consulting Group.
Fantastic. Thank you all for volunteering to spend your afternoon with us on these important issues. So I have several questions here. And I kind of want to start with some broad-based questions. And you know, and if you feel that this is a topic that you are particularly interested in, then, you know, just raise your hand and we can go in that direction. Unfortunately, having been here in Reno all of 3 months, I don't really know everybody and your expertise as well as I probably should. So, but let me ask you, so the first one is, how do we improve our definition of affordable housing of affordable to include other criteria such as transportation, job availability, and access to services? Okay, one more time. So how do we improve, thank you, our definition of affordable housing or of affordable to include other criteria such as transportation, job availability, access to services, and so forth? Then, in other words, I'll back it up. So we've seen a lot of metrics today that say, if you make so much money, this is affordable. And yet those metrics don't seem to include these other criteria, which absolutely affect whether or not something is affordable. And so I think the question is, how do we move beyond the idea of just looking at how much you make to these other criteria to determine what is affordable? Eric?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the funding programs that we work with, the criteria for...
Can you get the mic closer to you?
Is it not...
Or just
is it on? I don't know if it's...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. But just the home program, the Washoe County Home Consortium programs, the Nevada Housing Division programs, all of them have criteria that give higher scoring for projects that are in that are near jobs, that are near services and amenities, that are near public transportation. The home program has they've established priorities for funding, and one of them is being in a transit-oriented development district. So I think that that becomes sort of prerequisite for most affordable housing that's being built right now. I frankly, if you build it, it'll fill. I mean, the Silver State Senior Residence, 45 units of senior housing, it opened and filled in 1 month, and there's a waiting list of hundreds of people. So I think, you know, the developers are very conscious of where they're placed, but frankly, it's needed wherever it's located. The people will use it, and it's, you know.
Okay. Anyone else want to speak on that particular topic?
Yeah. I mean, if it's truly affordable housing, the criteria is built in within it. So is there a different term we use? I mean, the ones that are subsidized require those type of things.
Okay. Yes, please.
So if I understand the question correctly, it's kind of implying that anyone that needs affordable housing needs these other sort of supportive services. Like, I think by and large it's true, but I don't know we have a mechanism for screening people for that, because it's not absolutely true. But giving the level of supports that's appropriate to need is a mechanism that probably should be within any affordable housing project that we do, whether it's on-site case management, you know, or something like that, a process to it. But as far as changing the definition, I don't know that we need to expand it any more than what it is. Just know it's networked to other things, other needs.
Okay, great, thank you. So another question, how do you address housing for people with limiting factors? And just to define what a limiting factor is, for example, many people have challenges such as they may have a criminal record. They may not be able to afford the first month and the last month's deposit. They may have a disability. There are a lot of things that are quote unquote barriers into affordable housing. So again, the question is, how do you address housing for people with limiting factors? Please.
Our step one in concepting a supportive housing development is actually to begin by working with the nonprofit who will be our partner to make a list of the barriers the potential residents will face. And we then try to address each of those barriers in the housing concept. Mm-hmm. So for instance, if we were serving formerly homeless veterans, for example, can often have criminal records related to substance abuse issues, and the substance abuse issues are often related to their service. It all connects, right? And so by understanding that, we then create a development that meets their specific needs.
Please, CJ.
One of the things the Housing Division does is that we make financial resources available to our partners to address this. So you had talked about having enough funds for security deposit, and that could be a financial limiting barrier. And so what we do is we work with our partners, such as housing authorities, give them extra funds, and what they can do is they can make a security deposit loan, where then the resident pays it back over a 10-month period, and that seems a lot more affordable than to somebody who might have limited financial means.
Mm-hmm. Great. Other thoughts? Great. How do we achieve a sustainable balance of housing types and incomes downtown? And this is a much broader question, but basically the background here is that the individual was concerned that we would either have, that we're out of balance downtown, that we either have too much affordable housing downtown or we have persons of lower income downtown and we need this balance. And what is that balance? Please.
Again, it goes back to planning, but you know, zoning is one of the issues as far as the density of types of housing that you're going to look to be developed downtown. But there's also other policies that are out there, including inclusionary housing, which would basically set aside certain units for certain income distributions of housing, you know, as housing is being developed in the downtown area. That'd be one way of addressing, to make sure you do have a mixture of housing. But those are some of the tools that the city would have at their disposal, basically crafting those types of policies to have that type of inclusionary housing as development moves forward.
Okay. Would you take 2 seconds and just explain to the audience what inclusionary housing means?
Basically a set aside, if you will, a policy that the community would adopt, basically to set aside a certain percentage of housing units in a new development that's being created. So downtown, for example, if there was a 100 unit development that was being constructed, inclusionary housing ordinance could have some sort of set aside for five, to, you know, a certain percentage of housing units would have to be affordable or should be affordable to certain income populations within the community.
Other thoughts?
Yeah, I would say there's a lot of things you can do. I mean, I think it's a difficult issue. The goal of kind of downtown revitalization is to attract capital investment, and naturally that attraction of capital investment might put pressure on the low-income resident to live in that area. But in reality, to make downtown thrive, I think a big portion of that is trying to get more people to live down there, and that's in a variety of incomes. So I think that it's being strategic with your policy in terms of where you want to invest funds and things you might consider incentivizing. And if it's a priority to you to have a mixture of incomes downtown, then investing your funds strategically in areas where you think it makes the most sense to get preserve affordable housing, then that's what you do. I think it's used through your resources, your funding, your regulatory tools. How can you use those to strategically focus in specific geographic areas? And I think it's really that. I mean, it's naturally as your downtown revitalizes, I think it'll be increasingly become an issue. And another thing I think it is an opportunity here is you have a fair amount of existing housing. Some of that I would loosely call housing in the downtown area. I mean, some of that weekly motels, but they're potentially structures that you could invest in, or you could partner with the private sector to invest in to create permanently affordable units and improve the quality of those. You could find there's models in different communities where people have bought these weekly motel hotels and turn them into permanent affordable housing developments. And I think that's a strategy that the city could really look at, is how can we take our existing stock that is affordable just because it's old and it's in poor quality? How do we invest in that? And it might be cheaper than building new and making sure that remains affordable as reinvestment comes in, perhaps our vacant properties or you know derelict buildings as opposed to the replacement of some of this, you know, weekly or affordable housing now.
I'm sorry, Eric, please.
I'm sort of tired of hearing that argument. We went through this with the master planning related to the retract properties 10 years ago. At that point, we were saying some of this should be affordable, and there was this push, you know, it's all going to be high-end condos, because there was this vision that there'd be all these high-end people living downtown, and this was going to revitalize, and none of it happened. And our affordable housing properties downtown are the nicest apartment buildings in the downtown. They're anchor developments that they attract development. So you look at the Reno Artists, the Riverside Artists Loft building, which is a tax credit property. You look at the Carriage Stone property on Virginia and Liberty. And these are properties that are, first of all, I mean, let's just be clear that serving below 60% of area median income, that is our workforce housing. I mean, that's, most renters are below 60% of area median income. So this is not housing for poor people. This is housing serving our employees and so on. But I think that it would be great to see inclusionary zoning here and to see set-asides, developers having to make a set-aside of a small number of units so we could actually do truly mixed income housing. That would be wonderful to see. But I think just in the, but to say, you know, we're preserving all this land for this other high-end housing that may never happen and not using it for other uses is, I think, is, we already saw that, as I said, 10 years ago.
Now, I mean, just to piggyback, I think that's a great point. I think that affordable developers have a little wider array of tools to help address gaps that might make it easier to start with that affordable product as something to be developed in the downtown that helps spur market rate development. Because, I mean, the reality of downtown redevelopments, it's expensive, and you need as many tools as you can get, both on the market side, but also on the affordable side. And so I think leading with affordable housing is a good thing, and it could be an approach to spur all sorts of housing that's developed downtown.
So that's a good one. So I'm gonna lead into this. I'm gonna start, oh, please, first, yeah, yes. Absolutely.
And maybe I misunderstood a little bit, but you know, I was on that committee, 10 years ago, on the barriers. I worked 2 years on that. So the bottom line issue is we maximize very well in our community every dollar. So we really don't have anything to reallocate. We have to start thinking about where are we gonna be able to get other resources. So, the developers here that are doing affordable housing are doing an incredible job. The people that are experts are doing an incredible job, but they only have so many resources to get so many units done. So to start thinking about redeploying or reallocating, I don't think that's the answer. It's where are we going to be creative to think of other resources? And inclusionary zoning may be one of them.
Just in regards to the converting of motels, the Reno Housing Authority owns the Sarazen Arms Apartments, which is a converted motel downtown. We have very little turnover. It's a beautiful property, so it's very successful. We also work with Community Housing Resource Board with Joseph's Inn. They cater to homeless individuals. Again, it's a converted motel. Again, we have very little turnover, and it's an alternative affordable solution for those families. So that is another option.
Great. So this is going to lead into the next question. What are the biggest challenges faced by private affordable housing developers in increasing the supply of affordable units? So well, think about that for a second. I'm going to lean over to this table here, since you're the local folks for the most part. Obviously, Eric, you are too. But so again, what are the biggest challenges faced by private affordable housing developers in increasing the supply of affordable units?
Erica, what our developers have been telling us over the last 2 years, 24 months, is that it's been the cost of land and the cost of construction. They're having a hard time getting subcontractors, and when they do get them, they have to pay. The more they have to spend on those fundamental items of a project, the less units that we're able to provide. So I think that if we can, you know, work to address those kinds of things, like to look for donated land or land that can be had less expensively, construction issues a little harder to deal with, I suppose. But those are probably the two biggest hurdles that we hear.
Okay. Will you expand on, you said land. So talk to me really quickly. Just so everyone knows, in my private life, I'm a developer also in Utah, not here in Nevada. I'm a little more maybe knowledgeable on that topic. But please, talk to me about land.
Sure, as a
barrier and entry hurdle, yeah.
As the land has become more expensive, I mean, especially when you look at the limited resources that come with the tax credits, right. You know, there's only so many available. If you're chewing up a big portion of your cost in the land, you can provide less units. You just can't build as much bricks and sticks.
So what are the land issues? In other words, why are land prices going up?
Competition. That's the biggest thing. I mean, finally, I mean, we're very successful here in providing growth and new job opportunities. Right. The cost of available land has just increased along with costs.
Okay. Oh, on this side, and Eric, yeah.
The cycle for developing affordable housing, it takes about a year from conception to closing, and it's very hard to find land, a seller that will wait, that will be that patient to do a project. And so we talked about the Washoe County Home Consortium process. Mm-hmm. Just applying for home funds is about a 6-month process. So you apply in December, there are 5 public hearings, go on, it finally goes to the Regional Board of Governors mm-hmm. in May. And then you start your HUD environmental review process. And then, so, you know, there's a lot of obstacles to doing this, and to get a private seller to be patient is very difficult. So even if you could find land at a reasonable price, that's multifamily zoned, it's not been, I think, you know, we had this major rezoning creating TOD zone? I'm sorry, the mixed-use zones mm-hmm. in Reno. And so zoning has become much less an issue in the last 10 years with the mixed-use zones. I mean, almost every project we've worked on in Reno has been in a mixed-use zone, and it's sort of build as many units as you can as long as you make the parking work, mm-hmm. parking set aside.
Right.
So that's been less an issue, and I don't know that we've had NIMBY issues too much lately, but it's partly because there's just there's so little multifamily zone land available to begin with. That's where you're starting from.
Okay, great.
Well, not from a developer's perspective, but I think building on the idea that, you know, the cost of development is going up, and I think there are some low-hanging fruit that a lot of cities look at that Reno could consider, and that's looking at ways that you can reduce the cost of development for affordable developers, and whether that's waiving development fees or reducing development fees, or, you know, the city likely has a fair amount of city-owned property, and, you know, looking at that property and wondering, do we need this, and can we provide that to an affordable housing developer as something that they can build on? And so I think, to me, the lowest hanging fruits are related to that. How do we make it easier for these developers to come in? And I think it's, one, clearly stating what you want, and then, two, having a consistent policy for affordable developers to follow, so they know if they're going to do a project that the city's ready to provide these sort of incentives or these reductions to make that happen.
Great. Please.
I think it also matters what we're talking when we're talking about affordable housing. You know, are we talking about the low-income housing tax credit projects that are targeting the 40% to 60% area median income population? But as we move down that income spectrum, it becomes extremely more difficult to develop affordable housing when you're talking about people who have little or no income to pay rent. So that's when we start talking about rental subsidies. That really is another conversation that needs to take place when we start talking about affordable housing. So like I said, there's different pools of, or pockets of affordable housing that we have needs for in this community. And the most vulnerable population, though, is that 30% below. And that's where, you know, those projects are the hardest ones to pencil out unless you have some sort of rental subsidy.
Great. Please, CJ.
Just probably one final comment on this.
Yeah.
One of the other things that we've heard, we've conducted a couple of affordable housing workshops. And one of the things we hear from our affordable housing developers is that one of the obstacles is the pre-development cost. There can be $500,000 or more incurred before a project moves forward or closes on their permanent financing. And so managing some of those capital costs can be a problem or worrisome for some of our developers, especially some of the smaller ones. So one of the things that the council could consider is maybe there could be a deferral of the fees until closing, until like the it actually opens up for leasing. So that would be something that could be certainly adopted as a practice that would encourage affordable housing development.
Great, great comment. Okay, so getting into maybe something that's maybe a slightly more political issue. Sometimes when cities partner with developers and offer funding by various forms, it is perceived as a subsidy for the developer. Is that a bad thing? And can you explain why people might feel that way? So again, I'm going to repeat it. So sometimes cities offer incentives or money or whatever these things are that we're starting to talk about. Some of them, they could be deferring the cost of the development for a period of time. They could be maybe, again, we have it here in Reno where now you can defer your sewer fees until the time you actually take occupancy. Some people consider those to be subsidies. What are your comments on that? Please.
One of the things that the Housing Division does, and I think that is probably pretty common with most funding sources, is that there's restrictions on the funding sources. One of the things that we restrict is the amount of developer fee that a developer can earn. So it can be no more than 15% in most cases. And what we do is we actually incentivize if the developer has a lower developer fee, they're more likely to be funded. And so what we see is our developer fees are much lower than that. But they do have to make a profit to pay for their cost of business. And one of the things that we also typically see is that there's a lot of risks that the developers take on. And so if there's additional costs in the project, it's the developer that has to absorb those financial overruns. And so many times the developers do not get paid their developer fee. They have to defer it over a 10-year period. And so that's really what we're seeing at the Housing Division.
Interesting. Please.
You know, city incentives like that are a incentive and a subsidy for the development, not necessarily the developer. And as has been mentioned, the developer has really considerable upfront costs. And essentially, affordable housing developer is like a professional gambler, because you're putting in all that upfront costs, putting the development together, and your odds of being funded are, you know, maybe 1 in 5, 1 in 3 in a state with less competition. So you are risking a lot of money, and the developer fee you will be paid, it often takes 2 years before you see any of that money. Meanwhile, you have a staff and the money that you've put in ahead of time. So I think that, at first flush, it can look like the developer stands to make a lot of money and there's this big developer fee. In reality, I don't think it's the case.
And to say, in affordable, the affordability has to stay there for 15 years. So the risk is there in the long term, so they can only charge 30%. So, you know, they have to project their costs for 15 years in these affordable deals, so the risk is really high. So so maybe it is a perceived subsidy, but there really isn't a lot of subsidies in affordable housing. It's putting a big complicated puzzle together with high risk.
You would you just talk really briefly on what are the typical kind of returns you see on your projects? So people understand, you know, in other words, when you're putting this project together, what do you expect out of it?
Well, I will begin by saying that the Vecino Group's a relatively young company, so we're 5 years old. So our returns are in a shorter time frame than some other developers in the room. For us, what success looks like is a deal that's viable over the long term, that continues to be true to the vision that we set when we began concepting it, and it looks like well-maintained homes for the individuals who live there and a higher quality of life than they would have if not living at our developments. We really look at affordable housing as an opportunity to address broader social needs beyond housing. So whether that's, you know, things like helping to end the brain drain in a college town and helping to encourage working young professionals to stay in the community, or whether that's ending homelessness for mentally ill individuals, affordable housing is a tool to do all of those things.
Eric, I can give you a little color. Over the last 2 years, I've been tracking the developer fee, basically to put a number to it. As CJ had mentioned, we're capped at 15%. It's 11% is the average. And to make the deals work, that's where it ends up. I mean, the developer, as everyone has mentioned, takes all the risk. And to make the deal work at the end of the day, it comes out of developer fee. There's nowhere else for it to come from.
One individual here who would like to know about the gaps. In other words, this individual is concerned that we have affordable housing for particular spectrums, but there are some that are missing within our community. So who could speak on the issue of a broad spectrum of housing? how do we assure that we don't miss folks or that people don't fall into cracks?
I can't speak to the entire spectrum. We really haven't been tracking the homeownership rates that closely, personally, in our office. But as we moved in, like I said, at the 30% below, I mean, that's basically where a lot of the focus has been on, permanent housing, permanent supportive housing. And I think Eric alluded to that, you know, in Washoe County, basically, we have 17 units for every 100 households that need affordable housing. So the numbers, if you look at it, I think it was 17,000 households, and we need about 4,000 units right now just for that 30% below population. So that includes seniors, youth that are transitioning out of foster care, as well as people who are formerly homeless. So it's like I said, that's the bulk of the work that we've been looking at right now, basically because it is the most vulnerable population that we're dealing with. So,
well, in terms of what we found in our analysis, I mean, I would echo that. I mean, I think, like I said in presentation, I think renter households earning less than 50% of AMI are really the focus, and that's where the largest issues are. But to broaden that, to look at a couple other groups, I would consider home ownership, or at least existing homeowners. So there's a fair amount of folks that are homeowners now that don't earn a lot, and a lot of those are likely seniors that are retired or on fixed incomes. And I think something to focus on, in addition to that low-income rental market, is how do we maintain home ownership for these folks that have lower incomes? And so there's a variety of programs you could look at for that, in terms of, you know, maintenance and repair costs. Some communities try to address, you know, the cost of property tax and trying to reduce that. You know, that's a legislative change, but, you know, I think that's another area to focus on, is how do we maintain the ownership rate that we have? Because Eric sort of mentioned it. I mean, ownership rates are going down in Reno, and so I think that could be a priority. And then also, I sort of touched on it in my presentation, but in terms of the ownership side, I thinking it previously, whether due to the ease of getting a mortgage in the housing crisis, but or just lower costs, you know, an average worker in Reno could afford to buy a single family home, and I don't think that's necessarily the case anymore. And so a diversity of products is needed to allow people to have an opportunity for ownership, and that's difficult, but it's something that you need to make sure that you're planning for, and maybe trying to find ideas and strategies to try to encourage more development in sort of that attached condo type product that could be potentially more affordable to people that want to buy but can't afford a single family home.
I just wanted to give a little perspective, because Tony referred to the below 30% families, and those are the families that benefit from the subsidy that the Housing Authority offers. Our funding is limited. We only, you know, HUD continues to reduce funding. We don't get more funding. So just to get an idea, I mean, we have 2519 of our housing choice vouchers, project-based vouchers. We have 751 public housing units, and then 278 HUD-VOSH vouchers. So while those address that 30% and below, we're not getting additional funding for that. One other thing just to keep in mind, in Washoe County, there is 1,069 approximately project-based voucher units. Those are owned by private owners, but they do have the subsidy. So again, they're gonna be paying approximately 30% of that income. But you know, we have a waiting list. Those properties have waiting lists as well. So as the families move off, we're bringing new families on.
So you had asked about, you know, how we make sure that we address where there's gaps and needs. One of the things that the Housing Division does on an annual basis is we conduct a very comprehensive survey. And we survey over 25,000 units statewide. And we look at that survey on a regional basis. We look at Washoe County, we look at the rural areas, we look at Clark County, and we really dive down into the details to look at, you know, what are the needs that we're seeing out there? Is there a need for two bedroom units, one bedroom units? Is there a greater need for senior housing? Are there enough units that have features that are needed for individuals with disabilities. And so that's very telling for us. And then we use that to guide our policy decisions because we all know that our resources are limited. And so we do need to make prioritization. And that helps us to prioritize our resources. And so, for example, this last year, one of the things that really stood out in Washoe County here is that there was a crying need for senior housing, that the vacancy rate was near zero. And so that's one of the things that we looked at very closely of how we could make sure our resources and policies align to address that gap in need.
Obviously somebody coming and saying, hey, I need affordable housing. Proper metric for determining whether or not we have gaps.
Well, I know Des is sitting over there on behind the wall, but that's basically one of the requirements that HUD has for, you know, receiving the home and CDBG funds is they need to do a comprehensive plan and then basically provide updates on progress towards meeting those five-year goals that are identified in the consolidated plan. So,
yeah, I mean, I think that's a great point. You already do a lot of this, and I think it's trying to make it more transparent and accessible to the broader community. And in providing it data where possible to the folks and these people sitting at the table that, I mean, they probably do it themselves too, but, you know, the more resources you can share, it illustrates the problems more clearly. And I just to put a little a piece in about the master plan, I think you can build within there, and we're planning on building in indicators. And so you could start to develop indicators to help measure where you are in terms of affordable housing that'll help you adjust your course as you go in terms of shifting needs of the community. And I don't know, I'm an advocate. I deal with data every day, and I think it's a central part of policymaking. And so the more measuring and the more routine sort of use of data you can do to inform policy decisions, I think the better. And so setting up a mechanism to annually track where you are at, I think, is essential for communities.
We have time for one more question, please, Eric.
There's a book that came out earlier this year called Evicted by Matthew Desmond that talks about the impact of living in substandard and you're just barely getting by, living doubled up, living in substandard housing, being evicted, becoming homeless, and it looks not just at the tenants, but also at the landlords of very low-income housing who are often just getting by themselves. I mean, it's a very, very powerful story. And I think, you know, for Reno, we have an enormous inventory of motel housing that is our de facto affordable housing, and that is not, you know, that is not acceptable for children to live in, for seniors, you know, frail seniors to be living in, and that's, you know, has become our, you know, our affordable housing because we just don't have enough. So I think it's very hard to get at that with the data, but you definitely, I think we're seeing it with more homelessness, we're seeing it with more people doubled up. I'm just in my life, I'm hearing people from, you know, who I never would have suspected would have trouble finding housing, and are, you know, one of my employees of, like, you know, of just fine. And that, so this is, it's like very different than, we've never seen rents this high before in Reno. And, you know, and it's the change has happened so quickly where I think for the whole I moved here in 2002 and rents were basically flat for a very long time. Then they went down. Now they're going up in a way that we've never seen before. And I just think that it's, we're going to start seeing sort of those impacts, but not as much in this. I mean, it'll start showing up in the homeless stats. It'll start showing up in the service, people coming for services and so on.
And if I may, I mean, we have good stats. I mean, in addition to CJ and the vacancy rates, looking at where the needs are, you know, Ra's done the point in time snapshot. How many homeless do we have? How many are in the shelter? And how many are in the weekly motels? And in January, it's 3,680. And I apologize, I don't know the number, but it was significant. They were there for over a year. That's their housing. They can't get out of it. And you mentioned this de facto, you know, in mental health. Yes, but it's full. It's very disheartening to say we have the money to support you to find housing, and we can't find housing, even in the weeklies. Even in weeklies that the average person out there would be very uncomfortable going to, which is a horrible thing too. There's a saying I believe in it, but, you know, tell me who you walk with, I'll tell you who you are. You put people in an environment that is dysfunctional and you're already dysfunctional, your chances of moving along in the system and transition are very poor. You're just barely maintaining. And we're seeing people bounce back to jail, to hospital, inpatient, and they're just kind of cycling through. It's a huge gap. That first step, the supportive housing, that we're seeing in the mental health side for sure, and the homeless side. Move up, you match it up one step, great. I got a place with a roof and a lock. I feel safe. That's great. But then you get stuck there, and then you slide back. So I think that comprehensive master plan of what are all these different components that go into helping people continue moving up, that's where our focus has to be, instead of sometimes it feels like we're just looking for that silver bullet, tiny homes or a complex that can house 100 people or whatnot. That's got to be more than that.
We have time for one more question, so if we may. This last one is talking about what are the appropriate alternative funds to use to do affordable housing. So, you know, I've worked for multiple jurisdictions, and every jurisdiction seems to attack this issue or address this issue differently. Are there alternative funding sources out there that might not have been thought of, or that maybe are a little unusual? I know in our community here, we have blight funds, we have CDBG funds, we have others. Where I worked in Bountiful, we had an RDA revolving loan fund that allowed us to loan money toward projects above and beyond what the banks would do. In other words, the city would essentially assume risk in a project. So what are some other things that you have seen in your professional experiences that maybe we're not using here in Reno that could be potential assets?
But in our experience, and I don't want to be a downer with this, but there aren't a ton of easy revenue sources to find. And there's a lot of things you can sort of do as a community to nibble around the edges, is the way we sort of say it, or, you know, low-hanging fruit. But, I mean, at the end of the day, it does come down to finding funds. And when communities get serious about this, it usually means that they, as a community, need to figure out a sort of major shift. And you know, that's when you start talking about things like, you know, additional taxes, property or sales tax to fund affordable housing. You talk about inclusionary zoning. Those are significant major shifts that have major impacts and take strong political will and support from the community to make happen. And that's where I think you can go to get major revenue sources. But beyond that, I'm not sure that there are sort of unknown, easy to get revenue sources, unfortunately.
I would say that the city of Reno does not use its own funds for affordable housing. These are all the funds that the city of Reno relies on, are pass-through funds from HUD. And so, you know, we do see in other communities, and even CDBG funds, which are used routinely by other communities for affordable housing, are not used that way in Reno. We see room taxes being used for affordable housing because there's a synergy between room taxes and service employees. And so there seems like there's, you know, that makes sense in some communities to use the room tax that way. I think there are, you know, that there probably are more resources available than we're looking at right now. They're all small, but I think when you add them up, I keep on talking about that SCAP program from the state, because I think you're using a relatively small amount of money to leverage an enormous amount of money to make a lot of units happen. I think that's a really smart way of funds, of trying to get leverage. And, you know, the city could be doing that. One more example, Clark County had a pilot before the last housing crisis using BLM land for affordable housing. And what they had done was they had made it easy for the developers. They got the loan, the land zoned. They went through the BLM process to a certain point. They actually put home funds towards it, and then they put out an RFP for developers. And they had every developer. I think they got a dozen proposals because they had done all the work, but it was this very smart way of packaging, doing what a city can do, which is coordinate among different public agencies to make the resources available in a way that it's much harder for a developer to do. I think that's also true for service-enriched housing, where it's very hard for a developer to go to departmental health and to the housing and to other places and say, hey, we'd like you all to work together to develop supportive housing. I think that has to be coming from those agencies working together and packaging it.
Had gained a little bit of traction this past winter and in early spring, which was the Reno Tahoe Social Impact Fund. Basically, the whole idea behind it was basically to keep the money that's generated for affordable housing. The investors come from within the community. The resources are expended within the community. That was being supported at the time by the Community Foundation. There's been some inertia lately. It has kind of waned, but that is, again, is another idea that's out there for generating new resources, and that's basically would be resources that would be generated locally from the community rather than importing resources from outside. So again, that's just another model that's out there that's being discussed and talked about.
To build on that, some communities are getting very creative with the idea of social impact bonding, and where they're investing in or trying to get investors, whether philanthropic investors or even private investors, to upfront the cost of new age programs to reduce things like homelessness or incarceration rates and repay those investors through the reduced cost of providing service because of this. The upfront program is able to reduce the burden on those service providers. And so it's somewhat untested in the U.S., but it could be an interesting idea to explore here. I know in Denver, they're working on trying to set up one for homelessness and seeing if that's feasible. So, I mean, that's something to consider here.
On that, in Clark County, and they're basically getting some technical assistance right now from the Corporation for Supportive Housing to set up that same type of model in Clark County down in Las Vegas. So, again, that lessons learned down in Clark County hopefully could be shared with us. I think that'd be a bonus for everybody within the state.
Thank you, members of the panel. We appreciate your time. Can we give them a round of applause? We have several more comments here or questions. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take these, type them up, and I'm going to submit them to the panelists and have them give us written responses to these questions. So if your question didn't get it heard today, we will have these available in a few days or a few weeks, depending on how much turnaround time we have, to have answers for your questions. So thank you very much, Mayor. I appreciate you letting us do this.
Yes, thank you. I think everyone did a tremendous job. Absolutely tremendous. I'm so impressed. Really, really proud. And Tillery, where are you? I don't know where you are, but I think you did a fantastic job. Everyone that came together to make this happen, I thank you so much. It's been fascinating, and I think very, very well worth it. I know that we are going to go into public comment, but I'd love for you to stay right there, the panel, because I think in public comment, maybe some of you have some questions, but remember, we've got 3 minutes, so ask your question and then try to respond, you know, with this. I know it might be difficult, but maybe some of your questions can be asked that way. And I know that council, after we take public comment, then I'm gonna have council ask, and I would ask council to stay within the 3 minute time frame as well. But I think that people probably have a couple more questions, and if maybe we could do it that way. You don't have to ask a question. You could come up and just give some feedback, or, you know, public comment is fine. So it's your discretion. All right, sound good? Okay. Madam Clerk, do you have any public comment?
Madam Mayor, I have no new public comment form submitted.
Okay, so that being said, you could go and fill one out. I'm gonna ask everyone to put in for public comment if you haven't done so. And since you don't have any, then I'm actually gonna go to council members first, and then that'll give people time to put in some public comment. Sound good?
Would you like me to utilize the 3 minute clock with council as well, Madam Mayor?
Yes, I would, because I want to make sure everyone gets their questions in, and I know that some people have to leave by 4 o'clock. So that's why we're going to make sure everyone gets to go. I'm going to ask Paul McKenzie, do you have any questions? Council Member McKenzie.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and I'd like to thank the panelists. There's a lot of good information, but I'm one of my biggest concerns about the resources that we have as a city to assist in this is I don't believe we've been utilizing them in a manner to assist the most needed population. We have, the last couple of years, given home assistance, for example, to projects that didn't fill the glitch that we need to fill. And a really interesting example of that is the senior housing in Sparks that's 10% affordable, but then Amy steps forward and gives them vouchers to cover that. So that's a whole market rent. And we gave them home funds to build that, and then they're going to fill it market rent. So, but then the other really bad part about this is that once they get those home funds, they become property tax exempt. So we don't have funds generated in the county budget to provide social services. And if we're truly addressing the lower income individuals in our community, those funds for social services are as much needed as the rooms to, for them to be in. So I think we need to really step back and look at how we utilize the assets we do have. I think we made some pretty good steps with the deferral of fees for developers to come in. I think that we have a little look going around about what properties we may have that are usable for these type of projects. But I've seen that the majority of the assets that we've utilized in the past have not gone to address the true issue we have, and that's to get those people that are in the 30-40% range that are living in weeklies now, that are on a downward cycle that they can't ever recover from without assistance, to create a housing model that we can get them into and get them into permanent housing and get them out of the weeklies. And that's going to help boost up the reduce the homeless rates as well. But if we don't address that issue, the fluff that we've been throwing money at is not going to help our problem that we've got in the city. So I guess I'm done jumping on my soapbox that we need to use our assets to address the true issue rather than help developers avoid paying property taxes.
Thank you, Councilmember McKenzie. Thank you. Okay. Councilwoman Dewar. Sure.
Thank you. Great job, team, here today. I'm really focused.
3 minutes, sorry. I was just going to remind you. Okay, go ahead.
No. I'm really focused here today and going forward on the next steps. So this was a big education step for me in that it's a field that I'm not that knowledgeable about. I personally have participated. I've been wanting to meet Nancy for a long time in microloaning myself. When I come into contact with people that have needs, and it's been pretty successful, you know, on a one-by-one-by-one basis. I would love to talk about how do we expand those kind of programs. But in terms of right now, right here, it was mentioned that we have a 2008 plan, but yet it sounds like it's one of those that sat on the shelf and we didn't actually move out and implement it. And so I'm really looking for information from the panel on what was wrong with that, where are we now, how do we do these next steps to do something innovative along the lines of the second presentation we had from you today about here's some models from some cities. How do we get to those models? And then probably another issue I have is, for example, I have 3 affordable housing projects going on in my ward now, Ward 2, at various stages. But one of the challenges is, so they get $1 million from the state, which they did for the Sierra Summit. But then I learned today that maybe that meant that for the rest of their life, maybe they're property tax exempt. Possibly. I'd like to learn more about that, because maybe that $1 million should have gone to direct subsidies of some kind directly into the pocket of the people. So in other words, we put money to these projects, but are we getting the greatest bang for the buck? That's where I'm not understanding, where I'd like us to do more. And especially here at Reno, if the $1 million came from the state and it had these sort of criteria or clawbacks or whatever you want to call it, Should maybe the money come from us and not have that tax deferred status? Or maybe it should just have the tax deferred status to the extent if you provided 5% of your project affordable housing, maybe get a 5% tax deferral, not 100%. So those are some of the things, you know, being newer to this field, in that I haven't worked in it, but I'm extremely interested in it. I'm looking for some real stuff from you that we can do better here at Reno, you know, like next week, next month, this next budget cycle. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Does anyone want to respond to that?
Just a little bit of explanation, though, on the home fund. So the property tax exemption does only apply to the affordable units. So the particular property you're talking about, 20% of the units are affordable. The property tax exemption is only on the affordable units. That's actually in state statute.
Okay. So it is a ratio.
Yeah, and it's pretty efficient because it is only on
those affordable. That's a lot better than what I heard a little earlier today.
In fact, Nancy had pointed out that sometimes that's the difference between a project penciling and not penciling, because it's not just 15 years. Actually, we hold them to a 30-year affordability period. So for the long-term success of the project, they need to have the property tax exemption to help them offset the operating costs as they go along and the property starts to.
Well, I put this in as one of my questions, so I am hoping to get some ideas from you guys back if you're going to do written answers. Thank you.
Good.
All right, great. Did you want to respond? Go ahead.
Yeah. I hear you being very fiscally responsible, and I really like that. And I think part of the model is, what does it cost not to house these folks? What's the cost of all the emergency services and the crisis response? Because although the developers, maybe someone is making some money, I think as a community, we end up saving ourselves money if we really look at the big picture.
Well, all of this.
I encourage you to look at that as well and to pencil it out and see what makes the most sense. I'm on board.
Mm-hmm. Very good point.
One more comment in terms of just direct subsidy to renters. I mean, I'd be a little bit cautious of that, and realizing that, you know, you have, especially on the rental side, you have a pretty low vacancy and a lack of supply.
Right.
And just providing subsidy directly to the renters doesn't address that supply issue, mm-hmm. and actually can exacerbate it by increasing demand, increasing rents, and then growing that subsidy that needs to occur. And so,
well, I really like the idea I heard earlier from one of you about subsidizing the deposits. And putting it over a period of time, because that seems so much to be a barrier to getting where you need to be. That's presuming you have a place to move. I mean, to your point. But, I mean, at least that's a different kind of an answer than something else. Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much. Vice Mayor Delgado.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Same question. Looking forward to the answers and the questions that were asked by my colleagues, by Councilman McKenzie and Councilman Dewar. I know I stated earlier, Eric, you had said that we haven't done much with CDBG with affordable housing. I know earlier, maybe 2 months ago, we allocated $400,000 for the purchase of land for affordable housing. So I mean, that might be something new that we're starting to look at as well, being in, how to utilize those dollars versus what we've done in the past. Also, just from the panel, it'd be interesting to hear. I know recently we're looking at higher zip code areas, putting affordable housing in those places. I know my experience of even working in Detroit, where sometimes you run into some of those unintended consequences of now you have a community that was really utilized the resources that were around some affordable housing. Now you're putting them into a higher zip code area. What does that mean now in terms of the resources that are now available for them? Is that I know if I've experienced where kids now go to these other schools and now they're dealing with bullying issues. You're dealing with access to food, whether now that's an option, whether, you know, so it's just these bigger conversations about the unintended consequences of the placement without, I was saying, it sounds like a good idea, but we're now, what are some of these unintended consequences? Also to the conversation that I think Councilman Breck has brought up before previous in other conversations is, if you have a higher density, we know our issue in terms of city services going to now to these other places. And as Councilwoman Dewar explained earlier, if you're going with a lot of tax exempts, what does that mean for us in terms of making sure that there are services provided to those places that now may need those additional services that we know from stats and et cetera? So I'm looking forward to all these different questions. It's a very complicated question, very complicated. I know the mayor and I were here talking about all the opportunities from the products that Stacey had provided to us during the platform of possible, how do we utilize some philanthropic community groups here in town to work with some developers, other ways in how to fast track some of these projects versus just kind of waiting for the one project every year. One of the things for me, too, that I've seen as projects come forward every year, they're always kind of focused on senior housing. And we know that there's definitely a need for senior housing. It's going to continue to happen, especially in our we have a really great retirement community. But what does that say for the other demands that we have in the community? And how are we best utilizing that? I know sometimes those are that's low-hanging fruit in the sense of not having to deal with the NIMBY issues more often than not. You have for developers, you know, you have a that income, that sustainable income. So that's another low-hanging fruit for some of that, but we know that there's some other demands that are taking place out there. So looking forward to some of those questions, those answers being here in the near future. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. My question is actually, one of the things that I hear a lot from individuals is rental history. You hear that a lot. So what is your suggestion for some of these individuals when they can't get housing because of rental history? I see this a lot.
I don't necessarily have an answer for that. I know our families run into that as well, especially on the voucher program. And unfortunately, the rental history is up to each individual landlord because that's their property. They own that property, so they dictate what they're screening for. And so it is difficult for our families on our program if they have a poor rental history. We try to work with the families that are coming into our units owned by the Housing Authority on that rental history to provide them with that option, but it's difficult because, again, it's up to those individual landlords as to what their screening mm-hmm. is.
I think it happens more often than not, unfortunately. So.
This is Nancy. It is a housing issue, but it's a deeper issue in the way people financial security and financial wellness, and how we look at the individual person and help build their capabilities of making good financial decisions and also removing some of those barriers. So yes, it's housing, but it's also how are we looking at the person and also looking at, you know, are we running their credit score and trying to help them resolve those issues. So when they go to do affordable housing, I know that Amy at the Housing Authority, I mean, they are starting to integrate financial coaching. So it's a really holistic view. It is a housing issue, but it also is a lot deeper issue that we need to look at in our community. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Mr.
Maybe just to follow up on the mayor's question, is anybody familiar with an approach whereby either government or some nonprofit underwrites the risk in those situations? In other words, you know, somebody might be willing to get an apartment if somebody backs them up, almost like a parent does for a child. In other words, right. Somebody's there if they don't make the payment.
Right.
So
maybe action.
We have that kind of money. We'd be great.
Yeah, we're writing the house rules right now for a new 39-unit supportive housing development in Carson City, and it's all the service providers of Carson City are there at the table. And it's clear it's a tax credit property. It has project-based Section 8, so it can serve people with no income. And some of the things we're talking about is relaxed rental history rules of paying for a security deposit or waiving security deposit fee. I think that the issue is that there's more and more barriers because of the financial crisis and the number of people with credit problems. Mm-hmm. One of the things that has happened nationally is that the Secretary of HUD just announced changes in the way that for public housing, for screening, that for years you would, if you had a, not a conviction, but an arrest, you would not qualify for public housing or for Section 8 housing. And they've just changed that to say that if you have an arrest, that can be waived. And they're just looking at convictions. But there's just too many people who can't, who don't qualify to live in the mainstream affordable housing, which is a problem.
Mm-hmm. So I was going to say, was our Shelter Plus Care funding, it's HUD funding, federal dollars. It does allow a little bit of backing. So in addition to the security deposit, I think it's up to 1 month rent that we can compensate. Mm-hmm. And we have run into apartment managers saying, I want 3 times the regular security deposit. I mean, it's way out of line, but that's what we run into, and they have other options. Mm-hmm. But in answer to your question, Mayor Sheevy, was we negotiate. Mm-hmm. If someone has a bad history, we show how much wraparound services we're going to provide, and we mm-hmm. back it financially, the rent. We'll honor the lease, and occasionally we'll get a little movement there, mm-hmm. but it is a challenge. Mm-hmm.
Some of the payday loans for these kind of issues, and this is why I brought up the microloaning.
This is the cycle.
Yes, they want to get in, they get this quick $1,000, you know, $600 loan, and then pretty soon they're over in debt, and pretty soon they're being evicted. And this is exactly this cycle, and that's why I wanted to reach out to you, Nancy, because these are the things that I end up getting involved in out of my personal life. And, you know, we just have to do something about it. They can't be paying these exorbitant rates when they could be maybe paying 3 or 5%. And that's why I was saying some of this money go to some of these kind of issues, you know, direct cash to solve a little problem, mm-hmm. not a giant problem.
Right. And then credit history is right. really alarming. I mean, you know, I know that I struggled with it when I had my kidney transplant. And a lot of people, you can find yourself in that situation over a medical issue or a small issue, and then it really can cause a lot of barriers. So like you were talking about the individual and how we look at that, right? And then you could look at discrimination and all these different.
But there's models of cities for financial empowerment, where cities have taken an active role in the financial situations of their citizens. I know you're a different structure than some of the bigger ones, but, you know, here at Schwab, we're willing to help and to bring some of those best practices mm-hmm. to the city. So right. something I'm very passionate yeah. about.
And how many have you learned in school about credit history and what that, I mean, what are all the different levels of credit cards and thing, and the ramifications of that? I mean, we need Life 101, right? So that's great that you offer something like that. We should really look at, I know that wraparound services and things like that can sort of bring that, which reminds me of Reno Works, right? Which is great. So that being said, I'm going to hand it over to Councilwoman Jordan.
Thank you very much. And I was just going to piggyback on that and say all of the members of the Reno Works participants that I have had discussions with, the two things that did rise to the top, which I think maybe some of us take for granted, is a big barrier to rentals was their you know, arrest history. And even if there are potential ways to get there, their perception is, I'm going to get asked that when I go in and fill out an application, and I'm going to get denied because of it. So they end up, you know, in the motels, and they end up in the homeless shelter. The other thing was, as part of the Reno Works program, we do offer some kind of life skills, financial management 101. And I was really shocked at how little fundamental budgeting information that the individuals knew. So that was concerning as well. My big question about here today, maybe this is more directed at staff, is I think, you know, we could put shovels in the ground tomorrow and it'd be 2 years before something went vertical. And we don't have the luxury of time. We need to get a move on. So my question is, what is the next step? How quick is the next step? What stakeholders are we going to call in to see how quickly, you know, what of the menu items of CDBG for affordable housing, inclusionary zoning, using BLM land, Reno Tahoe Social Impact Fund, social impact bonding, waiving or reducing development fees, deferral of additional fees to encourage these types of developments. What is the next step? So we can have these conversations, figure out from these menu of possibilities which ones are non-starters, which ones deserve or should get more exploration, and which ones should we get rolling on right this minute to see what we can do. But we have to have stakeholder developers in the room. We've heard today, you know, that labor shortage, building costs, construction defect. Nobody talked about construction defect. You know, subs aren't jumping out there to do a lot of these projects because of the construction defects. So how do we get there, and how do we get there quickly is probably my question and probably a tough answer.
I'm actually going to have Tony answer this because I've asked him this many times and he's pretty brilliant. So
well,
this is...
Thank you,
listen
Mayor.
Carefully because this is...
No, actually, Nancy yeah. and I have had conversations this past week or so with the Enterprise Foundation to basically do exactly what you're asking, is to see if we can kind of bring all of these different groups that are working on different aspects of the affordable housing equation together with the key stakeholders to basically start building that next step. I mean, basically construct a master plan on where we are today, where we need to go tomorrow to get where we want to be. So, like I said, we're targeting right now for second week in January. To hold this, and you know, obviously we would invite everybody that's in this room today, but like I said, we really do need to have those different industry partners that really aren't the usual suspects because the only way we're going to address this question is, you know, change the parameters of what we're doing right now, because, you know, we have been covering our bases. We've been doing one or two projects a year here. It's making some impact on some people's lives, but we're not really addressing the larger question that's in the room today. So that's the conversation we want to have in January. And like I said, that's, you know, what we're working on right now to bring together. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, the city of Reno's here at the table, and we really appreciate it, but we're talking about the whole regional area. So that would be, you know, Sparks, Washoe County. Mm-hmm. And the nice thing is it will be also driven by the community too. I mean, with leadership from, and it's not to take the place of the plan, but some of the roadmaps we saw are where people come together and start saying, here is my interest, and starting coming together, and everyone comes with their interest and then takes their hats off and say, how are we going to get this done in different separate committees as a community, not just as public, private, nonprofit business.
Mm-hmm. And also to answer Councilwoman Dewar's question about the prior plan that was established actually by Eric sitting over there on the other side of the room, basically that will be the foundation for the conversation moving forward, because there was a lot of work that went into that establishing that plan. We don't want to lose that good work that, you know, that was already has been accomplished. And like I said, that's the foundation for moving this conversation forward. You know, what do we need to tweak? What's changed in the past, you know, 10 years and move forward?
Mm-hmm. I would also say, going back to your point, and you've brought this up many times, talking about our policy making and part of that, the inclusionary housing. And I think really being aggressive on the projects that come to the city, that we put those policies in place for development that comes in, that we can require that. And I think that, I mean, you've talked about this before, right?
I have, and if you look at the research, I mean, basically it's not gonna solve the problem completely, but it will add units. I mean, it has added units in cities that have adopted those types of policies elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Great.
I have a suggestion from the city of St. Louis that they did post-Ferguson that I thought was really energizing. As part of a community collaborative about affordable housing, they put out an RFP for developers to do a Shark Tank style pitch, and they gave developers a pretty nominal amount of funds for the presentation. I think it was like $300. A developer, but you had to come to the pitch and say what your idea was, how you would address the issue. In this case, it was very specific, economic housing integration post-Ferguson. And you would come and, you know, it would be like, we're pitching the city council, we're pitching the powers that be that control the funding. Here's our rendering, here's what we would do, here's what the cost would be, and then we'd be competing against six other developers. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, all the powers that be would decide. And I think that the thing that was so energizing about it was tangible, right? It wasn't like, let's just talk about ideas. It was like, here's the concrete plans.
Right. I like it.
Yeah, it was amazing, except it actually didn't end up fully being realized because they then didn't receive
money.
Funding.
Oh, okay.
So, cool in theory.
Good concept, though.
Maybe y'all could realize
it. Good concept. I like it. All right. Councilman Bobzian.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and thank you for sort of half stealing my question
a little bit.
But
at least we're on the same page.
But you'll appreciate this, because this is an elephant in the room. And I think it's something that needs to be talked about. And Tony, you are certainly a big proponent of this, and we've had conversations about this. And you had mentioned inclusionary zoning earlier in your presentation. And it strikes me that this is sort of policy question as well as process and convening kind of question. And I'm encouraged to hear that there is in the works this January convening of stakeholders to kind of talk about this and really kind of get a broader conversation going about all these different policies and how they come together. But, you know, inclusionary zoning means a lot of things to a lot of different people. And it understandably puts a lot of people, you know, gets their hackles up pretty quickly. And I've seen it time and time again, and I'm not going to call anybody out in this room, but I know exactly who's here and who has concerns about this every time this topic comes up. And yet you're right. I mean, there are examples of, you know, it's been in place in Montgomery County since as long as I've been on the planet, I dare say. So, and there are some successes, but I think also for the successes, there's plenty of examples of, you know, protracted legal battles and Supreme Court striking it down, saying, you know, this is nothing but rent control by another name. How do you get people together to kind of have the conversations to say, hey, don't, this is not something that you have to necessarily be afraid of if we can sit down and get your concerns taken care of? And I guess this is in the broader context of, at the end of the day, it's bringing together regulatory mechanisms, the hammers, and matching those with the incentives. I mean, if we get the sweep part realized, it's okay, what things do we have that we can put out as incentives that extract the ability for us to also then bring in the regulatory to get the right mix there? So this is not meant to be exclusively to you, Tony, and I'm certainly any other panelists that want to kind of weigh in on this, but I think I'm just saying that I think we need to have more conversation about some of these tough ideas that people are reluctant to have conversation about, not just inclusionary zoning, but that's obviously, you know, top of the list in terms of these hot button topics when it comes to affordable housing.
Well, I think the forum that Nancy and I are working on putting together with the Enterprise Foundation could be the forum for having those types of conversations. We did have an affordable housing workshop last April that CJ and Nancy helped co-sponsor, and we did bring in a group out of Oakland called Cornerstone Partners that basically have expertise nationwide on community land trusts as well as inclusionary housing and other affordable housing policies that they've been working with other cities across the country. So we're actually talking to them right now to come in to talk, you know, provide some TA on community land trusts right now, which is basically would be a component of another tool in the toolbox, if you will, for inclusionary housing or any other types of land donations that public or private entities would like to make to help reduce the cost of affordable housing. So those are like I said, we do have those connections, but I think this forum in January would be kind of that launching point for that larger discussion. But it does need to be, you know, a regional discussion. It can't be just be a city. You know, it needs to be Sparks and Washoe County as well, because housing is regional. It's not just going to happen within the, you know, city boundaries of the city of Reno. So, Nancy, you have anything else you would like to add?
And we did set a date, so it's January the 12th in the afternoon. So,
all right, everyone, write that down.
I think so. Our firm has been working in a lot of communities where we're dealing with a community or a portion of the community that's wanting inclusionary zoning. And actually, I would caution you to feel like that is necessarily a solution for Reno. We've worked in a couple communities, Denver, the city of Denver being one of them, where recently we helped them retool their inclusionary program because it wasn't working. And I think in a community like Reno, where you're finding developers struggling to develop anything other than high-end single-family homes, adding additional cost for developing housing is counterproductive to providing affordable housing. And so I think what you're seeing is, and sort of what you were getting at, is new age approaches that bring a mandatory program like inclusionary zoning and matching that with incentives. And actually, that's what Denver went to, what we helped them develop was, just the basics of it is they had parts of the city that building market rate housing actually hit their affordable standards. And so all their affordable units were just being built in this area. And it wasn't addressing where they needed the need. So what the city is going towards is a tiered system to where areas like downtown that have the highest need for affordable housing, there's higher mandates there. But there's also matching incentives that the city's bringing funds to help offset. And so what you're doing, the good thing about inclusionary zoning is you're getting the private sector who's good at building housing to build affordable housing for you, but you need to consider what cost that is to them and how you can support them in doing that. And so we worked with Denver. We've also worked with the community in Longmont. Longmont is a standalone community just outside of Boulder, Colorado. And so Boulder has, you know, a long history of inclusionary zoning, and it works for them, but you have to think about what are the things that drive affordability there. They are landlocked by choice. They decide not to grow outward, so that has an artificial cap on their growth. It's a high demand area. There's always demand for employment and housing. And so there's always going to be a need, and the needs are a lot more pressing than perhaps Reno. And so in Longmont, they sort of followed that model. And what happened in the recession is it created a bunch of deed restricted units where the owners couldn't sell them and they couldn't get out from under. And they started to get, you know, partner with sort of the development community to get opposition to the program. And what happened is the city completely scrapped the program and actually ended up letting a lot of people out of their deed restrictions. And so their inventory of deed restriction units went away in the recession because there was this downturn. And so it's something to consider. You know, there are downsides to those types of programs. And actually, we were just helping them in conjunction to their comprehensive plan restructure their incentive program to be to try to get at that. How can we create some sort of mandates or requirements for developers to help pay for this, but also what can we do as a city and community to help offset that through incentives? And one thing they're doing is contributing general fund dollars to their housing trust fund, but they're also gearing up to ask the community to consider a sales tax increase to help fund that too. And so a lot of communities are realizing that you need to not just put the pressure on one stakeholder. It's really a community need, and how can we all pitch into that? And I just to echo what I said previously, I think this forum is an amazing idea, and I think making sure you have all the stakeholders at the table to help come up with solutions is a great step forward, and something that you can help foster within your master plan after the ideas come out of this process.
All right, great.
Just a quick follow-on to that. Certainly, there's been a lot of talk about Reimagine Reno in our master plan update, but of course, also we have, and I think to the point that this is a regional issue as well, certainly just flagging from the Truckee Meadows Regional Planning Governing Board perspective, we are also getting ready for a regional plan. So as many of you know, a lot of the concepts that we talked about, planning concepts are also going to roll up to that, and so we need to have the discussion there, and that'll be the next venue. So the timing of all of these, I think, is great, and certainly, you know, to the extent that we can be conveners and assist in this larger conversation, because as we're finding out today, these sorts of substantive discussions have to go far beyond just the 3-minute public comments that we need to hear. We need to have this broader, deeper conversation and have a big table for everyone. So thank you again to everybody that came today for being a part of this.
Great. Okay, Councilwoman Brookes.
Thank you, Mayor. And I'll just, you know, I know it's getting late. Just thank you to everyone also for coming and our staff who put this together. I guess in my mind, I try and conceptualize what I know is the subsidized housing market, which is our federal programs. And I do think it's just a drop in the bucket of what is done, what our housing need is. So I block that off. And I think, you know, some of the other discussion, particularly later in the day, has been more on, you know, what's the market going to do and what the market needs to do. And the work that we've done on the master plan has really helped us understand that. I missed Matt's presentation, but, you know, the findings on our phase two document that from 2000 to 2014, 72% was this detached single family, which is a product that we have now twice as, you know, is only going to be 50% of the demand going forward. The other demand is going to be all these other density projects. And I appreciate the cautionary tale about the inclusionary zoning they've been doing in California for years, and it was just upheld by the California State Supreme Court in the last year or so. And so, you know, I do think for a starting point for me would be our land use planning, and I'll be very concrete in a couple of examples. Just today, some of us were at Tumwa, and we augmented a budget of about $1.5 million, almost two, to a capital improvement plan to help get water out to Verdi. And it's an area where we've seen, since I've been on the council, two subdivisions come through and some not commercial. But you know what? If we're going to back that with our public investment for bringing infrastructure out there, which is assisting those, you know, the market, we need to also do some land use planning for the multifamily and more affordable product. Likewise, we had a controversial development last week that came here, and they were quarter acre lots. Maybe we should have told that developer, I'm sorry, you're going to be delivering 20% of your mix is going to be off these quarter acre lots. And I think that we're at a point in our region where the private sector is not going to be able to go into these expansive areas with the infrastructure costs. So in return for that investment, whether it's roads, sewer, or water, I think in our land use planning, we're going to be telling you, you're going to be bringing in a mix of uses. And oh, by the way, we're going to be standing on that mix of uses, MF21 and above, and that has to come. No developer-driven zoning changes to meet our land reservation for the product that needs to be delivered to the incomes we have. So I think that's very exciting, and I think that I appreciate the January conversation, but I think that's a direction our master plan will be going in. And just on the affordable side, I think we do a great job. The 2008 study, I look forward to revisiting that, because I think there was some implementation lacking. I'm always interested in what are the aging out projects, because I think those are just getting picked out off by market rate developers, and displacement is resulting from that.
All right, thank you. Go right ahead.
Large inventory of most affordable housing that gets subsidy from the city of Reno or from Nevada Housing Division has a 30-year to 50-year affordability period. I mean, it's actually all of it at this point. So that there is a bond housing that is aging out at 15 years, and the owners have an option for going market rate. And I think at this point we're losing more affordable housing stock than we're gaining because of what's called the qualified contract process. And so it's another area that just of holding on to what we have costs much less than building new.
All right, great. I'm going to send it to you, Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I know the council said it, but I wanted to, on behalf of the city, thank each and every one of the panelists for taking time out of their day to come and educate both the staff and the council, a very important subject matter, which obviously isn't going to be resolved easily. But again, thank you very much. And then I also wanted to thank the staff that pulled this together, Tillery, Bill, Dez, and Eric. I thought they did a great job in bringing forward a right group of people to really present the council with some good information. So thank you to both the panelists and the staff.
Yeah. All right. At this time, we're going to go into public comment.
Madam Mayor, our first public comment is from Mike Thornton, followed by Paul Lennart.
Great, thank you. The hour's getting late, so I'll try to be brief. Thank you very much for holding this today, and thanks to Tillery for putting it together, and thanks to a bunch of great panelists for giving us a tremendous amount of useful information. I'd like to lift up something that was said earlier, and that was having clear, articulated goals and values. We presented a suggestion that perhaps the council might pass a resolution to that effect, which we still think is a good idea. The other thing that was raised was the issue of how do you know about the gaps? And one of the things that I would say is to make sure that those people, as Councilmember Bobzian says quite often, that the table is big enough for the people who are not usually at the table to be invited. And that's the most affected residents in our city, but also those that aren't easily identified as the most affected residents. But without having meaningful, substantive discussions with the people who are most affected, data is great, but you lose a big part of the story, and particularly the human element. So I would encourage you to include that as well. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much.
Paul Lennart, followed by Eric Young.
Wanted to thank the panelists and the city council for putting this together. One thing that that you've done is make me more aware of just how incredibly complicated doing anything within the current system and balance of power is. It reminds me of the Greek myth of the Gordian knot. It was this very complicated knotted product, and various people would try to unwind it. I guess what occurs to me is that I hope you guys can work this out. I really do. Because the last 2 years of my life have seen me go from being at the bottom of the top quintile in income earners to living on Social Security and PERS due to a heart condition. It has seen my stepson, because of his mental condition, be unable to live with us any longer. And of course, now he's pretty much varying between the motel weeklies and the street. And there are more and more people like me as the years go on. And at some point, there will be a critical mass of us. And at that time, people will be talking more in terms of cutting the Gordian knot. I hope to God you can untie it first. Thank you.
Madam Mayor, our last public comment is from Eric Young.
Good afternoon. I'm Eric Young from Senior Planner at Washoe County Planning and Development. Like everybody else, thank you so much. This was a great afternoon, great for me. I think everybody else here too. I've been on the Washoe County Home Consortium Technical Review Committee, I think, for going on 15 years now. So I've seen every affordable housing project in the community for the last 15 years come through and reviewed the application and reviewed what many of the business people and developers in here will know as the pro forma, the financial plan, or in the common language, how it's going to pencil out. We have to make it pencil out is the common term. And what that means is putting together a pro forma that shows at least usually 15, 20, sometimes more years of affordability. And I've looked at those pro formas all these years, but it wasn't until in the last few years when I had to manage Washoe County's Neighborhood Stabilization Program funds that were some funds that came in from the federal government to help us deal with some of the neighborhood problems from foreclosures. And we were building some affordable housing, and I had to do one of those. We had to put together a pro forma. And how complicated that was and how difficult that was, even having had 14 years of experience of reviewing them, until I actually had to do one, I didn't really understand just how much of a puzzle and complicated it is. And so I think I'd like to suggest, if it's at all possible, if someday you could invite perhaps Eric or Matt Fleming, one of the other great developers of affordable housing here in town, to come before you and show one of their pro formas that they did for one of the projects that exists, is on the ground now in town, and talk about some of the challenges they had in putting that together. We had one recently, I think Eric mentioned one of the projects where labor costs just changed. People like to call it the Tesla effect, but you know, who knows where it really comes from. And from the time they started penciling out the project to the time they got the home funds, the prices of what it was going to cost to do it changed so dramatically that they had to come back to us and say, our pro forma is just not going to work. And I think that really looking at what it takes to put one of those together, what it really means to do a pro forma with 20-year affordability, with rents that are capped at a certain percentage of income, and you will get an understanding of what that tax exemption means. It's illustrative of the tax exemption. It's illustrative of the discussion on what it would mean for somebody to have inclusionary housing, if we're going to throw that at a developer, what that would mean. It is illustrative of so many things. It will explain so much of what it ultimately means, because whatever we end up doing and what's going to happen in January is so fantastic, so beautiful that that's happening. At the end of the day, somebody's going to have to sit down and do a pro forma that works, that pencils out. And I think that you would really love to see, to have Eric or somebody else come and present one of those to you and discuss to you the challenges that they had. Thank you very much.
I think that's a fantastic idea. And I'm so glad that you came today. Thank you so much. It's really important to have, you know, the county here as well. You talked about it. It's not just in our city, but all over. So really grateful that you did come today. And I did see Dane Hilliard here, and it looks like he left, but I think he would be probably a great person, and for you to come back and really show what that looks like, because to your point, and you were saying how difficult it is and how long it takes, right? And what we've seen before is that, you have a developer that comes in and they've spent a long time on this, and you talked about 2 years at least, okay? 2 years at least. Then they come, they do all that, then they come to council, and we sit up here and think, okay, how can we help them, you know, become sort of their partner? And then they take a lot of public scrutiny, because sometimes it looks like, okay, you're incentivizing, you know, these projects. And so, you know, that's another thing that they ended up just getting so frustrated at that process. And sometimes we have to really treat them as partners and not adversaries, because I've seen that too before. And, you know, and that's why we want to be open and transparent about this type of housing and how we can all make it work. But I mean, look at how frustrating the process can be and how long, right? So, I mean, the people that do these projects, you really commend them, because it takes that kind of tenacity to get you there, right? Wow.
Madam Mayor.
Can I say something? And I appreciate that. As a bank, we do investments. We have some of the best affordable housing developers in this town. When Eric comes to us, or when Silver Sage Manor comes to us, we know those deals are great. I mean, they don't come with something that's not going to work for us. So I want to commend the people we do have in our community. We don't lack developers. We lack resources for these developers to do more. So I think the affordable housing community in here, in this community, does a great job with the limited resources they have. And I thank the city council for their interest.
Madam Mayor, several months ago, Councilwoman Breckus asked staff to look at properties that we had that may be usable for affordable housing. And I think one of the big things that we heard today from all of our panelists was the fact that that initial investment of having a property to build on is probably one of the things that's deterring them the most. And we do have an inventory of property that we need to figure out a way to get back into the economic stream. And I would urge that we offer that partnership as an easy choice that we can make right now without doing any changes to code, without anything else, to go through that inventory and really look for properties that these developers can work with. Mm-hmm. And bring back some plans for development on those properties that we have. I know that when we initially discussed the properties that the staff found, we only had three properties. I think that with a little more research, they could probably find a few more. And the easy things that we can do that we've got complete control over are the things that I would urge this council to take the first steps for and assist this community in moving forward with developing affordable housing.
And actually, Councilwoman Duer and I actually sat down with a couple developers, yep, to really try, and that's what they specialize in, to really sort of look at our inventory. And so I think we can do a much better job about marketing, you know, that potential partnership. Absolutely. But if it was easy, everyone would be doing it, right? I mean, it sounds like it's intensive.
It's almost like, you know, they need a kind of pre-screening process where they know if they invest this kind of money and this kind of time and this kind of energy that it's probably going to work. You know, because I've had three of them now come to my neighborhood advisory board, and we're scrutinizing them the same way we'd scrutinize any development. And I'd like to get that scrutiny process earlier in the game, so that we're not at the end when they're about to go to planning commission, you know, right, asking these kind of questions or making sure it's vetted. You know, that just might be one thing.
Right.
One different kind of idea.
I like that idea, because I think, again, it's difficult, and then they have to come up here and we grill them, and mm-hmm, like you said. Councilwoman Darden.
Thank you. And I'm glad you guys brought that up, because I think something that I've certainly heard out in the community is, you know, the uncertainty of what, mm-hmm, potential developers are going to get when they come before us.
Right.
And I think if we can collectively agree what the menu options or the, you know, the things that we're going to look at, and those were not, at least we're giving some level of stability towards those out there that are looking to invest their time and money in our community as to what they may or may not get when they come to us, because that is causing some hesitations with some out there because of the uncertainty, what we're going to potentially do up here. And that's keeping some from jumping in.
Well, and it's that too, but it's also neighborhood acceptability, which was brought up earlier about the NIMBY issue. And I will just point out, it's kind of interesting, you know, we have this project, this property near Virginia Lake, and it was planned to be a skilled nursing, a memory care, and then some independent living. And the developer came in and said, well, how about swap out the skilled nursing for this Matthew Fleming project that had 44 units for veterans preference. And in talking to the neighbors over and over and over again, they said, we wanted that project because it's to help veterans. And I mean, they, even though they didn't want multifamily there so much, they were willing to overcome their objection because of the populace that it was being aimed at serving, lower income with veteran preference, which doesn't mean it's going to be all veterans by any means. But anyway, it was interesting where we saw them again recently on the other half of the property, and hundreds of people showed up to say, no, we don't want that. So, you know, I don't want to get into naming names, but my point is that even though it was for low income, veteran preference, multifamily, stuff they didn't really want, they were willing to overcome their objections, which we then saw just 6 months later, a big fat no for something else. So it can work both ways.
All right, Madam Clerk, do you have any more public comment?
Madam Mayor, we have no further public comment.
All right, thank you very much. So with that being said,
move adjourn.
You're quick. I have a motion and a second already. I don't even have to announce the item. All right, thank you so much for coming today. Really appreciate your input. You know what I like?